Attention. The movie guys love movies, and this week sees the release of another Coen Brothers movie. Looks like another one of those Greenwich Village folk singer with a cat has girl problems movies. Didn't we just see this? No. Never. We have never seen this.
Good ear at the writing meeting.
Yes, such can be said about any Coen Brothers movie.
And it'll be the best version of that we've never seen before.
Yeah. You would just crystallize the Coen Brothers. That's a perfect statement.
If anyone ever wants to make another version of that, it's not going to be as good.
Nope. It will not.
Whatever Lebowski is, it is the best one of those that has ever been made.
And it's the only one.
Welcome to the Movie Showcast, everybody, part of the vast and sprawling Movie Guys empire. It's a sweater! You've reached ground You've reached ground zero for all things movies and comedy. We bring the two together right here on our show every week with rants, sketches, previews, characters, jokes, bits, special guests, and more. You can expect that in the next hour or so as we broadcast from the Admiral's Club, locked in Burbank Airport's flyover zone. Catch us on iTunes, SoundCloud, and YouTube. Search the Movie Showcast or the Movie Guys, and we come right up. And don't forget, we're also available on WBAD Radio at WBAD.net. We play there Fridays at 4 p.m. Eastern, 1 Pacific. And as always, please subscribe where possible. Tell your friends. Share and like posts and videos and all that stuff at the Movie Guys on Twitter and on Facebook, YouTube, wherever you find us. My name is Paul Preston. I am your host, here as ever with Lee Caius, Adam Witt. The Karen Volpe chair is empty. She had an audition tonight. We'll see if she makes it back by the end of the show to do her birthdays. Later in the show, we'll be joined by an actor who has appeared in the likes of the Spider-Man trilogy, Patriot Games, and of course the TV shows Hercules, The Legendary Journeys, and Xena Warrior Princess. Ted Raimi is coming to
the Admiral's Club. Legendary Ted Raimi.
And if you're new to the show, I think you'll find our signature offering each week is a thorough preview of every major film release coming up in theaters. Coming up this week... Are you tired of movies not having enough people getting punched in the head? Well, here comes Out of the Furnace, just for you. And later in the show...
I'm interested in gigging here.
Okay, let's hear something.
You don't want to hear the record?
Why should I? You're here. Play me something. Play me something from inside Llewyn Davis.
Fairly well.
Aw.
They're going to do it again, aren't they?
Yeah.
They're going to nail it again. And also invent it. While they're doing it.
Yes. Invent it and do the best that there is. Man, it feels like it's been forever. When was the last Coen Brothers movie? Was it A Serious Man?
That was after No Country?
No, True Grit.
No Country was 07. Grit. No, True Grit.
True
yeah.
Grit,
which
what
is weird.
They do after
I always
that?
Forget that. And that had 7 Oscar nominations.
Yeah. I forget that that's a Coen Brothers.
And as with Coen Brothers movies, it's one of those that I've heard, once you watch it like a second time, you're like, oh, it's completely brilliant and amazing. I mean, the first time I saw it, I was like, I liked it, and it was whatever. But, you know, you spend so much time adapting to the world that the Coen Brothers are created. It's almost like I always say about Adam McKay movies. You got to watch them a second time. They're like, you haven't even seen them yet.
That's true with Anchorman. I saw Anchorman years ago. I saw it very recently, and it was much funnier.
I
liked it the first time, but I mean, really enjoyed it the second time.
That's the thing.
You didn't walk away from the first viewing going,
that was weird, but now I appreciate its absurdity so much.
Yes. I laughed a lot the first time I saw it. The second time, I became fanatical. I mean, absolutely just below Airplane, my second favorite comedy of all time.
Oh, wow. Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah. That Airplane and that. Woo-hoo.
Now, there's of course, something to be said for the Coen Brothers in that you want to see their movie a second time to begin with. And we will all do that, no doubt. But our first film really looks like it takes place in the 80s, but it doesn't. The harshest possible counter-programming you can think of for Frozen. It's Out of the Furnace. Let's talk about it. Adam? You'd think if your film had a white guy sleeping with a black woman in rural blue-collar steel town in Pennsylvania, that would be your movie. But there's more to Out of the Furnace.
Yes, this tense and suspenseful drama features a black police chief in a rural blue-collar steel town in Pennsylvania. You'd think that would be your movie, but there's more to Out of the Furnace.
From the director of Crazy Heart comes Crazy Shit. This film takes place in a rundown community in Appalachia's Despair Belt, where the locals have been left in poverty after the country music plant closed.
Christian Bale plays Russell Bays, a local steel worker who falls on hard times when he's born in a rural blue-collar steel town in Pennsylvania. It's a part, I'm told, Bale gained several million dollars to play.
Oh, he's method. Russell looks after his family, including his ailing father, who's come down with a case of waking up in a rural blue-collar steel town in Pennsylvania. And his younger brother, with his younger brother and Iraq war vet Rodney, played by America's favorite Affleck, Casey.
But the family loses its heart and brains when Russell lands in prison after accidentally killing someone. Yeah, I believe we have a clip of this scene.
Oh, okay.
Oh, good for you! What the fuck is it with you?
Oh, sorry, that's not from Out of the Furnace. That's from Bale's performance in 2006th, The Gift That Keeps on Giving.
Oh, yeah. Without Russell to keep him out of trouble, Rodney joins the locals in the burgeoning local economic stimulus of an underground fight club to make money. It was either that or the job at Walmart, and at least the fight clubs are upfront about crushing your soul.
That and the fight club at Walter Reed Hospital, sponsored by the VA, has a waiting list.
But when Rodney refuses to throw a fight, he's kidnapped by mobster Woody Harrelson, who's stimulating the local economy by chewing scenery.
Hey, Paul, in 1988.
Yes, Adam, in 2013.
You watching Cheers?
It's 1988, of course I am.
Hey, guess who the most successful cast member of Cheers will be in feature films?
Ted Danson.
No.
Shelley Long?
No.
Kirstie Alley?
Nope.
George Wendt?
Nope, not even George Wendt.
John Ratzenberger?
No.
Rhea Perlman?
No. It's Woody Harrelson.
Whoa! That is weird. Well, as long as one of the people I mentioned gets a TV spinoff.
Didn't they all get one but Rhea? Or she got one?
Nobody got one, but Frasier.
That was the joke.
No, yeah. Wait a minute.
We didn't mention Kelsey Grammer because who would guess that the one character from Cheers...
I'm looking at the list, I'm like, they all got them, didn't they?
No! You're thinking of, you're thinking of Friends. You're thinking of Friends.
Yeah, you're right, sorry.
They all got two. So when Russell gets out of jail, he's lost his father and his brother is missing. Events shitty enough to make their previous lives seem hospitable in contrast. He decides to take the law and a sniper rifle into his own hands as he hunts down the men that took his brother.
And right when you think being a hot chick would bring you everything your heart desires, here's why it sucks to be Zoe Saldana. This movie stars Academy Award winner Christian Bale, Academy Award nominee Woody Harrelson, Academy Award nominee Casey Affleck, Academy Award winner Forrest Whitaker, Academy Award nominee Willem Dafoe, Academy Award nominee Sam Shepard, and Zoe Saldana. That kind of sucks.
That does suck. The trailer makes the film look like a two-hour-long Pearl Jam video, and it was actually set to feature some freshly recorded songs from the band's frontman, Eddie Vedder. Cool. But after hearing the final tracks, director Scott Cooper said the songs were too good to be included in the movie. Let's hope that thinking didn't go into Cooper's directing style. Wouldn't want to make sure the performances from the Oscar winners are too good or anything.
You gotta rein all that good stuff in.
Can we make that shittier? Hey, Christian, shittier, please? Less good?
That's not a direction he often hears. Make it shittier.
When you mentioned the despair belt, something that came up on the radio that I heard this week, a stat that they do every year, once again, the Bible Belt leads the country in divorces.
But where is the Bible Belt?
Well, the buckle is
pointed
like
out on a map.
Oklahoma is
the buckle.
Yeah, where does the Bible Belt go? Because it's
Tennessee,
like,
and Kansas, and
is Ohio?
Oh,
part
well,
of the Bible
like
Belt?
Mississippi, Alabama.
No, I don't think so. Okay.
Like Mississippi, Alabama, up to like Iowa,
Arkansas.
Or
I think it even stays a little north of there. I think.
Yeah,
it's like Arkansas and Tennessee and all that. But you would think that's where Out of the Furnace takes place. No, Pennsylvania. Because the South can really creep way
the
up there. I did
Rust
some work
Belt.
When I lived in Chicago.
Oh,
yeah,
West Virginia is the South.
Yeah. Well,
Baltimore.
2 hours south of Chicago is the South. Like Champaign-Urbana is the South.
Maryland,
if you're not careful.
Well, I mean, you're saying farm country. Farm country is everywhere that isn't the first 25 cities that come to my head.
As far as a as far as a career goes, or a job, right, farming. But I'm talking about some people I met at the county fair in Champaign. you know.
Oh, I did that the summer before I moved to L.A. I was I was out of a job and I had to fill the time. And my friend worked promotions for the Illinois Lottery, and they had set up a booth at the at various fairs. And so I was a carny for a summer.
You know the Illinois Lottery? It's hillbilly life savings. That's the retirement plan.
Oh man,
hillbilly retirement plan.
I gotta tell you, man, that was the saddest fucking thing, because you're just watching them all play the lottery. Like I kind of watched them play the lottery all day long and do scratch offs. Nobody wins scratch offs. Come on, nobody wins. I mean, nobody wins the lottery. Statistically speaking, just don't do it.
Yeah.
But anyway, but we had like fun games and stuff like that. But holy shit, is there some serious, like Springfield, Illinois, and Carbondale, Illinois is might as well be the
North Havenbrook. Yeah. Shelbyville.
Put them on the map.
Is the middle of nowhere.
I think it's more of a state of mind. The South.
Well, I was working a Hawaiian Punch promotion. We were giving away
a
beetle. Right? So we were at the fair. We had a whole corner of
a literal bug.
I think we should come up with a theme song for Paul's latest promotion story. Like, I was doing a promotion for Sunny Delight. Right, what did you do?
What did you promote
when you were poor?
What did you promote? What did you promote for money?
Yeah, no shit, right? Short of selling my body.
Hubbub.
We had a whole beach set up, and we were like Hawaiian. We had like straw hats and Hawaiian shirts, and we had this Beetle. We were giving away a Volkswagen Beetle, so he came up, he signed up, and we had Jimmy Buffett music playing. And a little kid came up, he was like, "What music's that?" Like, he's like a high schooler or whatever. Like, hey, Jimmy Buffett. Yeah? What do you like? I'm like, I like rock and stuff. Like, yeah, I like Peter Gabriel.
Skinnerd!
I like Peter Gabriel. Dude, he's gay. Like, I don't... Who are you? What's too hot? Just get out of here.
Metallica, dude.
And then I look over and, no kidding, a guy is in his scooter wheelchair doing donuts in our sand.
Nice.
I have some amazing pictures from the fair. I have the. You just reminded me of one picture. There was an old man in a rascal cart, and he's got his old cart decked out. However, and then there's just a little sign on the front that says "Here comes trouble," and it's just this old guy in his rascal. That's one of my favorite photos.
I don't mean to veer too far off topic and get back to the movie, but
all this could happen in the movie.
I do want to mention Casey Affleck.
Yes.
Did I pronounce that correctly?
Casey
Affleck.
So.
Affleck. I always say
Affleck.
Yeah.
Affleck because he's related to Ben Affleck.
Affleck.
But I could be wrong.
Ben Affleck. I love that band.
Ben Affleck.
Oh, Ben Affleck and the Affleck Tones.
Yeah, and the Affleck Tones. But he was
America's favorite Affleck. Anyway,
Casey was on Conan the other night. And
I love Casey Affleck.
He's getting a little man crush on Casey now.
He's coming around.
I won't tell Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
Have you seen
Jerry?
Don't tell Ryan Gosling either, because he had a kind of like tough guy vibe.
No, but you know what? It's cool to like Casey Affleck. Yeah. It's not that everybody likes. I mean, the other people you just mentioned are super popular, but like Casey's still got a little.
That's
indie
why everybody
thing
likes
on.
Them.
You know,
that song
right.
that everyone likes.
You're right. It's that's literally the definition of everybody likes. Sorry. Yeah, that's true. You know what's not only does everybody like him, but they're popular
and good. But anyway, yes.
But Casey's funny. I mean, I love Ocean's movies. The conversations that he has in that, his tone of voice and stuff.
He's pulling for me. He's pulling a Fight Club, literally and figuratively, in this movie.
He is in Fight Club
because he's in a Fight Club and he's doing. In this movie, what Brad Pitt did for me in Fight Club, which is make him not so, you know, wishy-washy. There's a scene with him and Woody Harrelson where they previewed it on Conan last night, and Casey is just going to rip his head off.
Oh, it's like their first meeting.
Oh,
they're
yes.
in like the old. He's playing poker.
Yes.
Woody is badass in that scene. That's a great scene.
But Casey is just like just right here in his eyes, and the line is "Teach me a lesson," and that's all he hangs on because Woody Harrelson says it as a throwaway comment, and he's going on with the conversation, and all Casey's character can hang on is "Teach me a lesson." You gonna teach me a lesson? Teach me a lesson. I'm like, kill him, hit him in the face.
Yeah. Love Casey Affleck.
So I'm on board with that.
And if Jonah Hill said that, it'd be hilarious. But man, I'm a big fan of Woody's. I think
amazing career for him. That little
my God.
Little sketchlet we
as,
did
as
there.
Steve Scholz said, who writes for the show, he said, This seems like it might finally be the performance that drives Woody from Cheers off the cliff of our collective memories. It's been going on for a while.
I gotta disagree with Scholes. I mean, I haven't thought of him as the guy from Cheers since Natural Born Killers.
Right.
I mean, he really did. I guess he really did what you'd call a Johnny Depp, which is weird to say because nobody has thought of him as 21 Jump Street's Johnny Depp for decades. But it's amazing, and. In fact, it's so rare that you go, oh, yeah, it is weird that that guy from Cheers is this guy.
Him and Cheers and Depp and 21 Jump Street are the types of things people still have to look up on the internet to make sure that happened.
Yeah.
No, I don't think you're right. Oh, yeah, they were.
And Oswald acted alone.
I mean, Harrelson was in 3 Best Picture nominees and one that won in No Country for Old Men. He's got 2 nominations himself for Larry Flint and The Messenger. I just think he's fantastic, and I look forward to anything he does.
Wait, who's nominated for Larry? Oh, Harrelson. Harrelson.
I mean, if it's when he's funny, I love that too, Zombieland and that kind of thing. I think I'm glad he returns there every once in a while, but he can bring both genres, the funny and the serious. I love it.
It's pretty cool, and it's just doesn't seem like your typical career. You know, you think of all the, like, you know, Hollywood does not need handsome people. Honestly, I mean, if you look at most of the people,
I don't get work.
Your Brad Pitts, but you know. Woody Harrelson, we love that guy. And Casey Affleck is not traditionally good looking either. You know, like these are just the almost character actors.
And real quick before we move on, he's doing the one thing that I want to bring into real life. He's got hair in this movie, and we're like going with it. He just shows up with a full head.
Yeah, it's true.
Would you start doing that as a bit on this show? Just to, and then working in your real life.
I promise you, Adam,
get a fucking wig. I want it.
I promise
you. Make more money now. Do it.
It is literally a financial issue. The good ones are expensive, I'm understanding.
Save up.
Can't you just, like, reshape one every night?
I just want to see you walk in with fucking preacher hair, man. Like TV preacher hair. Like
Benny
televangelist
Hinn.
Hair. Yeah. And you're like, hey, this is my hair today. Yeah. And we just realize and get used to it. Get used to it. That Lee's going to bring a wig.
Nice hair.
And you wear one. Maybe you don't wear it the next day, whatever.
This is what I'm saying.
Then you save
this
up for a second one. And then you start getting a bunch of them. I'm back, Mr. Luthor.
All right, well, Out of the Furnace shows the economic realities of an impoverished community in America. And it's not just a plot point. It's an actual initiative that Hollywood is spearheading to help. Listen to this message from the Hollywood Chamber of Commerce.
When America was hit by the Great Recession of 2008, Hollywood decided to do something about it by forming the New Economy, LLC. A coalition of producers dedicated to making movies that reflect the economic realities of the 21st century.
It's every oligarch's dream to pay to watch toothless bottom dwellers try to kill each other over a plate of stale nachos. Now, with the positive influence of the movie Out of the Furnace, showing Appalachians bare-knuckle boxing, there are over 400 hillbilly fight clubs around America, pouring thousands of dollars into economically depressed areas. And offering affluent captains of industry an exciting new sport to bet on while enjoying the age-old hobby of watching the poor suffer.
But that's just one of the ways Hollywood is giving back. Last month, audiences enjoyed Homefront, which emphasizes the profits to be made from meth dealing in the South. Thanks to the lobbying efforts of the New Economy, they didn't hire some typical heavy for the villain, and that meth kingpin ended up being played by the lovable, funny, and personable James Franco. Meth remains a $5 billion a year industry, giving the poorest Americans an opportunity for upward mobility that wouldn't be available otherwise. Of course, some of that would be happening without Hollywood, but we're doing our part to make it acceptable.
Would there be so many stand-your-ground shootings without the movie The Purge? Maybe, maybe not. But the economic impact of paranoid people hoarding expensive guns might not even be noticeable without the rugged good looks of The Purge's Ethan Hawke.
So we can't take all the credit of the success of America's New Economy, but we're doing our part to popularize new ways of making money for these pre-apocalyptic times. And we won't rest until we can actually televise children killing each other in the woods with flaming bows and arrows. Because if the movie The Hunger Games has made $1 billion, do you have any idea what kind of ratings the real thing would get? Now, if you'll excuse me, I've got a meeting to convince Harrison Ford to play an organ harvester in a new family comedy.
Oh, there you go. So earnest.
Wow,
so,
that's a real thing, huh?
Yeah, it really is. those voices of other people from the Chamber of Commerce explained it all. All right, our next film is Inside Llewyn Davis.
Like more sincere.
I'm sorry, what was that, Paul?
Inside Llewyn Davis.
Oh, yes, the sequel to the porn Deep Inside Annie Sprinkles.
Actually, it's a Coen Brothers film.
Well, man, then it's going to be a really good porn film.
Yeah, you're confused. Just read the script with me. Here we go. Joel and Ethan Coen do for folk music what they did for bluegrass in Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? With Inside Llewyn Davis, a film that explores the pre-Bob Dylan atmosphere of Greenwich Village in the early 60s.
Now, for anyone who doesn't know, the Coen brothers are mythological beings that were granted great powers of filmmaking by the movie gods. The only thing the gods asked for in return for their ability to make brilliant film after film that defy categorization was that the Coens would never be able to set a movie in the same part of a decade twice. If they should do that, their powers would cease.
Inside Llewyn Davis follows a down-on-his-luck musician.
In movies, is there any other kind of musician?
For a week, as he couch surfs apartments and coffee shops of the beatnik era of New York, when the first generation of hipsters thought they were the first generation of hipsters for the first time.
1 week? Talk about genre-specific. With this kind of narrow focus on time periods, I'm sure we can look forward to other period pieces from the Coen brothers that take place in 8th grade lunch, the 30 minutes after eating but before swimming, and of course, August, Osage County.
But of course, talking about a trailer for a Coen brothers movie is like describing Beethoven's Ode to Joy in pantomime. These are always such cave paintings for what this will actually be. I get it. It has to be explained in some way. You can't just put a title up and put the Coen brothers there on black screen for a minute and expect people to show up. But you would, wouldn't you?
I totally would.
You totally would.
Llewyn Davis is played by newcomer Oscar Isaac. Well, he was in the movie Born Legacy, if you want to call that a movie. He was also in Won't Back Down, so I assume he played a pit fighter, because that's the name a movie about a pit fighter would have.
Wait a minute, is John Goodman in this movie?
It's a Coen brothers movie, isn't it?
That answers that. Otherwise, the cast is full of Coen newcomers, including Carey Mulligan's Bangs and Justin Timberlake, who plays an insipid folk singer whose notoriety rubs the self-involved Llewyn the wrong way. So, Justin Timberlake now adds a Coen brothers movie to his cool indie cred. Can this guy make a bad decision already? Isn't there a terrible idea for a superhero movie that he can embarrass himself with just once? All this, and you're good at hosting Saturday Night enough already.
Damn you.
By the way, when's Runner Runner coming out? It's him and Ben Affleck, so I assume I'll see a commercial or something.
This film also stars F. Murray Abraham as Bud Grossman, a club owner who could give Llewyn his big break. Let's play a clip where he describes Llewyn's music.
This was no composition by a performing monkey. This was a music I'd never heard. Filled with such longing, such unfulfillable longing. It seemed to me that I was hearing a voice of God.
Well, spoiler alert, sounds like he likes the music.
Yeah.
good news, Lee, the film is at least partially based on a book, so that makes it a movie, right?
It makes it a partial movie, Paul.
It's partially based on the biography of Dave Van Ronk, a forgotten folk singer.
Is there any other kind of folk singer?
With a visual mood adapted from the cover of Bob Dylan's album Freewheelin'. The cultural era they're putting on film is a very romantic one that's rarely seen. The first pulse of the baby boomers claiming art for themselves in the salad days before Magneto shot Kennedy and we all had Nixon forced on us.
The Coen brothers are never ones to run out of ideas for movies, but apparently the old creative tank is a little dry when it comes to characters' names. You'll remember that in No Country for Old Men, the main character's name was Llewellyn Moss. Here, our lead's name is Llewyn Davis. I have nothing funny to say about that. I was just wondering if they didn't think we'd notice.
Joel Coen was quoted as saying, "The film doesn't really have a plot."
What?
No plot? That never stopped Brett Ratner from making a movie.
Nailed it!
Well, in the hands of lesser directors, not having a plot would be a problem, or at least result in a Michael Bay production. But no plot for the Coen brothers simply means that this film could conceivably go on forever. Isn't that what we all want from a Coen brothers movie anyway, for it to never end?
Will the Coens continue to bat 1,000? Or maybe 850 when you take into consideration Lady Killers? Looks like it to me.
It does. This is the number one movie I want to see for the
I was telling
the
Paul,
holiday season, the awards season.
Before you got here this evening, I was telling Paul, I was listening to an interview with
Oscar Isaac,
newcomer. which I pronounced it with a B for some reason.
A newcomer. I can go for a newcomer.
A honey newcomer.
Could you put some newcomer on the salad?
I was just listening to an interview with him on not Fresh Air, some other NPR show. Mm-hmm. And just based on the interview, I want to see this movie.
Yeah.
They weren't playing clips. They weren't doing anything. He was just talking about the movie. And I'm like, holy crap, we need to see this.
I saw one clip of this, and it was him and Justin Timberlake, and the guy gets up on, and I can tell already where this you're going with this character, and it's going to have that sort of Coen humor to it. It's not a comedy. Fargo's not a comedy. Mm-mm. Fargo's got a lot of laughs. And
shut the fuck up, you know. Like, that guy really needs everyone to calm down because there's a. But it's hilarious when he says it.
Absolutely. And as the guy gets up and he starts to announce the next act, and he goes, now, the next. We actually want to have someone come up here and play a song. And Oscar Isaac gets this look on his face like, oh, I couldn't. Oh, no, just move on without me. But of course he's talking about Justin Timberlake, you know, and of course he gets to the point of announcing him, and Justin Timberlake's playing like a totally insipid, like, I'm trying to think of like a folk act that was totally like, you know.
Hated? Or
loved, like, at the time, but just completely insipid version of it. I don't know, I'm not very good at referencing my folk music. Anyway, that's the sort
of. Me neither, I'm hoping I learned something from the movie.
Well, that's the thing, how many folk song movies are there in this setting? Ah, man, fuck these guys. They're too good.
They are too good. They're the best.
They've risen to the level of fuck them.
And to expand on the quote we said earlier from Joel Coen, who said the film doesn't really have a plot, he furthermore said, that's why we added the cat.
Yeah. When I wrote the joke, I couldn't quite add that in there.
Yeah, I
was looking at the quote. I'm like,
well, I want to make sure that came up, because I thought that was hilarious. That's why we added the cat. Yeah. So now there's some kind of through line.
What a Joel Coen thing to say. On top of being good filmmakers, they know how to play their Beatles-esque characters as well, you know?
Not the least of which, of course, is Roderick Janes, who we almost did a sketch about Roderick
Janes. Oh, yeah, their editor.
Because he's their editor. Now, if you don't know, the Coen brothers edit their own films under the name Roderick Janes. So even when Roderick Janes is nominated for an Oscar, or wins... Did he win?
No, got nominated.
They send up an Indian.
They put up a exactly.
But they put up a picture.
They put up a picture of some old man. I don't know who it is.
It's hilarious.
As the guy being nominated, as if he's not there.
Now, are they not allowed to edit their own movies, or is that just a funny joke?
I think you
joke?
Had a story about that. Didn't
or
you?
Was an ASCE something?
Some union deal?
No, there's nothing. There's nothing preventing it. I can't remember why they did. I know Soderbergh doesn't credit himself as cinematographer because he doesn't like seeing his name up there too many times, but I don't know.
That's humbling. I'm
not sure why
it's humble, I should say.
Yeah,
because
sure
you are taking work away from somebody.
Them.
Yeah. Were they going to get?
They're going to get fined.
They're going to get fined.
The union's going to come after.
Now, as envisioned in a Coen Brothers screenplay, no doubt Llewyn Davis will be one of the most interesting Llewyns imaginable. And like we enshrine the goofy names of characters in Ender's Game into the international order of ornate sci-fi and fantasy names, I would like to immortalize Llewyn Davis into the Llewyn Hall of Fame. Very prestigious. Now today, we speak the names of the great Llewyns in history.
Llewyn Davis.
We speak your names.
I guess that's all there is.
Yeah, that's it. That's all. That's all we have.
Just to show you how original those goddamn Coen brothers are. You're right. Fuck them. It's not fair to everybody else.
It's not fair.
It's just not fair.
It's an unbelievable streak.
Yeah.
That's. I mean, they're like. I remember with that little joke about them being gods with special powers of filmmaking. But they kind of are. There's just nothing else. I mean, how do you keep doing that? How do you keep making a completely original movie?
It's
completely enjoyable and a risk.
Yeah.
And they maintain their punk. They never, no matter how popular they get, they're never considered to sell out. They never, and then they'll go do
they're
some.
They're never out of touch.
They're good, never out of touch. And then they'll go do some personal film, like the guy who stands.
Serious man.
Yeah, I want to call that
guy
movie.
Guy on the roof.
Guy on the roof. Yeah, guy on the roof.
Jew on a roof.
Yeah. Now, I want to go on record as saying I understand there's a certain hypocrisy to my previous, though no longer, discontent with Leslie Mann. Because basically, Frances
You've come to terms.
Yes, I've come to terms with her as
How did you get there?
I saw her in...
Did you shuffle the lead topic?
No, I see where this is going.
He knows where this is going. Yeah. This is going to Frances McDormand, who is always...
Dormant.
Frances McDormand, who's always in every Joel and Ethan Coen movie, and I've never once said, well, she's just getting it because, you know...
Yeah, she's married to Joel.
She's not in that many, though.
This isn't enough.
I mean, she's in Fargo. She's in Burn After Reading.
Oh, that's
she's
right.
in Raising
she's
Arizona.
Reading,
yeah.
She's in.
But never
gotta get him a dip tat.
Never once did that thought about her enter my head as it did with Leslie Mann. But as you know, I'm on the Leslie Mann bandwagon. Love you, Leslie.
She's married.
Rumor has,
which is how we started Francis. This whole thing.
I believe I've heard that from Lee.
All right, well, we're going to take a short break, really 10 seconds of this song for you, a small break for us, and we will return with our guest, Ted Raimi. We're
Ted
very excited.
Raimi!
There we go.
It's
going
to be good. It's going to be good.
Trouncer the Mighty roams through the countryside. He never needs a place to hide with Gabby as his sidekick. Fighting with her little stick, writing rocks and singing songs, the Mighty all day long.
Had to be
Trouncer, Trouncer the Mighty.
And yes, we are back with our special guest. He is an actor from the big screen, appearing in Darkman, Drag Me to Hell, and most recently Oz the Great and Powerful, and on the small screen in Sequest,
yes.
and Legend of the Seeker, and more. Plus, he writes, directs. Please welcome Ted Raimi.
Hello! Hey, that's me. Yes, that's me.
Oh! A guest with his own theme song. We never had a guest with his own theme song.
Yeah, theme song, yeah. Had a theme song. Yeah.
It's not too bad.
No, it's pretty cool.
That's a catchy tune. Did you write that?
I did. I wrote. Well, okay. You know, the orchestration is not mine. The orchestration is a guy named Joe LaDuca, who scores a million.
Oh,
things.
Oh, I knew that.
Army of Darkness.
But
score,
I didn't
one
do
my
that.
Favorites.
Yeah, he did a lot of a lot of soundtracks. But yeah, that theme was, I think it was Rob Tappert's idea, the producer of Xena Warrior Princess, which that's from. And it got to the director, Josh Becker, who said, you know, Rob wants a theme song. So I had an idea, you know, roaming through the countryside, something, something, something.
Oh, it writes itself after that.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, then it, I mean, I got it. I was like, what do you mean a theme song? Like, how could he? Well, actually, it didn't really turn out to be a theme song. Excuse me. It was really originally meant for a scene where I was tied up with Renee O'Connor in
talk
the
slowly.
Scene.
Talk slowly.
Yeah, so I was tied up with her. And because we were stuck in a room with our hands tied behind our backs, he wanted something that would really be annoying to her. So he thought, so it was really smart. No. It was really a clever idea because what's more annoying than somebody singing who can't sing? And you're just stuck for days. It's like being your cellmate. You know, it's not like, you know, hey, man, you know, I'm your cellmate, you know, now you're going to suck my dick or something. But that you might even be able in time to adjust to.
And who hasn't been there?
But what you couldn't adjust to if you went, hi, I'm your new cellmate. La da 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 da. La 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 la. And then you go, wow, I'm living with that forever.
Here, suck my dick so you shut up.
So it's something. So that was sort of the idea.
We're going to be together for a long time.
Yeah. We came up with that whole thing. That is bittersweet. It actually became the most, you know, emblematic thing of that character on that show. But also, I'm asked to sing that at every single convention I've ever been to in the last 15 years. All the fans eventually, sing the Juxer song.
So when I played it, you're like, oh, great.
It's fine. It's fine.
I wondered how tired he might be.
No, I'm not tired of it anymore. I don't sing it anymore. I used to, like, in the early days. Now I just, you know, I just...
Well, maybe hearing the full produced piece sounds different than, like, a bunch of fans screaming.
No, it's about the same. It's all about the same.
Yeah, you were a beloved character on Xena.
How often were you on
comic relief?
I was comic relief. That show lasted for 6 years, and I was. But originally, the fans did not like me on that show.
Oh, really?
No, they hated me because I was brought on at the end of the first season. By that time, Xena and Gabrielle were very serious characters. I mean, because that show was a spinoff from Hercules.
Yeah,
and Hercules was a goofy show.
Was it always from the beginning?
Yeah, Hercules was always lighthearted. Come on, Aeolus, I'm Hercules, the strongest man in the world. That sort of was the vibe, you know. He was like a goofy American who happened to be a half-god kind of a guy. So Xena was a serious spinoff of that one. She was like a serious character. So I came on the last episode, the fans went, okay, A, this isn't a comedy. They wrote in, you know, in the earliest days of, like, you know, email.
It wasn't?
No, they went, no, it was not. It's not. They went, it's not a comedy. And there's a guy in the show. What is a man doing in this show? Because even at the end of the first season, it was becoming a very, you know, a gay, lesbian sort of thing. For a lot of fans in an underground sort of sense. So they didn't want a guy.
That's why I watched.
Yeah, I think a lot of guys did too.
I did
you
like...
were killing my boner, Ted. Watching that show, man.
Well, yeah.
He was a you boner
know,
killer.
Well, I was. You know, I like Joshua was sort of asexual idiot, you know.
No, that's how we that's how we referred to you. Oh, the boner killer.
I was a boner killer. I'll buy that. I can live with that. But it was, you know, that was sort of, and then eventually I was very fortunate. They wrote good stuff. And it was based, you know, Joxer had a great comic premise, which was, it was endlessly malleable, which was, he's the worst warrior in the world who thinks he's the best
great.
Warrior.
It's great. Yeah. Very Monty Python.
It's just a classic, you know, it's Bob Hope.
Brave,
you know?
Brave Sir Robin. Yeah.
It's Bob Hope going, you know, you need help. You know, it's all that stuff. You know, I was totally channeling Bob Hope and Danny Kaye and Woody Allen through the whole thing. You know, I was stealing from the best. Why not?
Are those some of your comedy influences?
Yeah. They were, those and guys? That they I love, you know. There's, you know, even the worst Danny Kaye movies.
You can't go wrong with those guys.
No,
you pick good ones.
Yeah, I you know, why not? You know, I mean, it was, those guys are, you know, totally. I mean, Woody Allen, obviously, for the fact that, you know, it was two incredibly pretty waspy girls, and there's a Jewish guy. So I mean, nobody really got that. I don't think when they were watching it, but it's the oldest, you know.
Sure, he's going to get laid.
Sure, he's going to get laid. Never does. You know, it's whatever. It's Seinfeld. It's all that stuff. You know, it's just classic pair ups. You know, and then Bob Hope, just because he's just so cocksure of himself, but he's an idiot. And Danny Kaye, just for the antics, you know. Yeah, you know, I totally borrowed from those guys. I totally admit it.
You know, they say a Jackie Chan script will have plot, 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 plot. And then eventually a page will just say Jackie Chan fight scene. And they figure, well, that'll all get worked out on the set. And then you flip the page,
yeah.
Plot, plot, plot. You think
I
it was like that
it.
For Danny Kaye? Like, plot, 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 antics. Plot, plot, plot.
Sure, because what are you going to, I mean, what are you going to say to Danny Kaye? Be funny? Danny, here's a routine I worked out for you. You're never going to, that's never going to be as good as
oh, you don't want to lay that on him. Yeah,
you no, you don't. Him, no, you don't. Do
you know. I thought you were going to say that Jackie Chan scripts say, you know, plot, plot, plot. Danny Kaye antics, blah, 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 or blah, blah, blah,
I would
Bob
bet you,
Hope.
I would bet you Jackie Chan cites similar influences. You know?
Yeah, oh, no, he definitely does. I mean, he most certainly does. Yeah. Most certainly, yeah. He loves that stuff. So, yeah, I mean, if you're going to borrow, you know, don't borrow from some schmo you saw on, you know.
He yeah, always so said, he always, the best. He always described the difference between him and Bruce Lee as Bruce Lee is, duh, you know, and Jackie Chan is,
right, no,
that is
right.
Right.
It's such big pantomimes too. He's always good at just showing that. I mean, really selling in the wrestling terms of, oh, that hurts so much.
Well, one thing Jackie Chan did for kung fu movies, which is seldom mentioned, is he made it accessible for families to go see kung fu movies. Oh. You know, if you saw kung fu, that was basically like, well, it's porn. I can't take my kid. It's too violent my kids. But this was violent, but always in a lighthearted way, like old school slapstick. Huh. So kids could go see that movie. He wasn't a bad guy. He was always a good guy.
The reason I love Jackie Chan is that he holds the record for title in a movie in Super Cop. It's like the
Isn't
third.
Isn't it the first line
it's
in the
like
movie?
It's like the first or third line in the movie. He turns to him and goes, "We need a super cop." That, after that, I am
title.
I am
we have title.
I am watching that movie.
How much pondering is there going to be in that movie? None.
I just think they should just make that illegal to say the title of a movie.
Oh, really?
There's no reason. I guess it's kind of fun for movie buffs, but if you're just a regular guy watching. You know, I don't know, Sugarland Express. We got to take this Sugarland Express till it ends.
Did anyone ever...
Oh, that's just a saying?
Hey,
that's
do you
just
see
a crazy saying that everybody
magic?
Knows what that is.
Hall pass. He gives you a hall pass. That's a horrible made-up word. That's a made-up word.
Holy shit, it's the Evil Dead. I mean, no one said that. Right?
Yeah, you can't say that. You can't. You're not allowed to say that. You're allowed to say Spider-Man. That's okay, because
sure,
he calls
that's
himself
a name.
Spider-Man.
It's going to be silly if you avoid that the entire movie.
This is an impossible
mission. You're not allowed to say this. You know, Pineapple Express or something. That's it. That's just not fair.
Well, it is August, Osage County, and
well, that's like Spider-Man: The Reckoning, right? That's like the colon title.
The Reckoning.
Hey, now that we're talking about great films, let me ask you the question I ask every guest who comes on the show.
Yes, sir.
Your favorite film of all time.
Ted, this is what we were talking about before. Yes. There are right and wrong answers here.
There are right and wrong answers, so I'm going to try and get this one right. Yeah. Let me think very, very carefully about my answer.
Into the movie dunce chair.
Into the dunce chair, right over there. Well, you know, the movies I love the most vary. It just depends on my mood. I have a million of them that I love.
Today, we should ask. What's your favorite movie today? Because I think anybody in this room could have a different...
normally, if people... like, you know, look, I do a lot of horror, and I do love it tremendously. I would say... but lately, I've been watching sort of these old-school adventure movies. So right now, my favorite movie of all time is The Man Who Would Be King. It's John Huston movie.
Yeah. Sean Connery.
With Sean Connery.
I've never and seen it.
One of the it's few Sean Connery movies I actually like. I'm not a big Connery fan. I know you Bond guys are going to kill me, but I'm not. But
he is a wife beater. But anyway,
yeah,
it's really hard to like. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah, but you know, I mean, his personal life. Yeah, totally. But his personal life aside,
Mel Gibson had to do a lot of good in the 80s for me to even like go, oh, it's whatever now.
I would say that I like that movie in spite of him.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's an amazing movie, and that's probably my favorite movie right now of all time. I mean, you know, I can watch. It's one of these movies I can watch 1,000 times.
Yeah, that was going to be my
watch it over and over.
That was going to be my follow-up question, which is the one of the criteria I use in determining my favorite movie is the movie you can watch no matter what. Because there are better movies than my favorite movie, but they are too much of an emotional investment that I can't watch them.
Right. So right.
That for me, A Few Good Men is absolutely the best movie ever made. There isn't a wasted word, a wasted action.
No, I'd agree with that. Yeah.
You can have it on in the background and burn it.
Yeah.
Like burn a view.
And you can drop in. You can drop out.
You're not sitting down. Yeah.
But there's other movies you just have to invest yourself in from the beginning. And then you're done. You're wrecked. You got to take a nap.
Yeah.
Rehydrate.
Yeah, it's like Stanley Kubrick movies, you know, like you can rail against them and you can say this and that, and I don't love them all, but I will say this about any Kubrick movie, I can turn it on at any point and be completely sucked into it.
Yeah.
Oh.
No matter what movie it is, you know. I don't love them all. I think my favorite Kubrick movie, though, and this is another weird one, is, oh, now I can't remember the title.
There's some titles for you.
Great, I brought it up.
Dr. Strangelove.
Spartacus. Nope. See, you're not getting the
Lolita.
One that I'm thinking
of. The World War One.
No, it's with Ryan O'Neill.
Oh,
Barry Lyndon?
Barry Lyndon. I love that movie. Oh, man.
Interesting.
Yeah, and you know, Kubrick is... what I love about Kubrick so much is that he's great at getting these kind of average actors to give really extraordinary performances.
Ryan O'Neill.
Yeah.
One of the over...
Who knew, right?
One of the most overrated actors of the
Tom Cruise is another one.
Oh.
I think he's got some dynamite moments, but overall I think he's acceptable and stuff, but...
Paul, your guest is getting...
Do I need to stop him? Big Cruise fan here.
Oh, you're a big Cruise fan. What I mean to say is... Did I say that? I meant phenomenal.
Thank you.
I don't know. You know, it's funny. You're spending all those years in the Royal Shakespeare Academy. Mediocre comes out as phenomenal. That's just the way it is. No, I'm just teasing. But listen, I appreciate... Listen, I like him, but I don't love him.
Going back to Barry Lyndon, interesting thing about that movie, I got on a Kubrick kick when I was in college, and I watched as many of the movies as I could, and I watched what I thought was most of Barry Lyndon, and then later, like maybe 5-6 years later, I put it in, or it was on, or something like that, and I was like, oh, you know, I don't think I watched the whole thing. And then I sat and watched the whole thing again. Now, that is a boring movie, and yet each time
it
I
is.
Watch it...
It is a little boring.
All
of his movies are kind of boring.
Yeah.
They're all like a halfway through. I mean, I have not watched 2001 A Space Odyssey once and I've fallen asleep, and then still woken up and gone, wow, that was a great movie.
Oh, you know the key to finishing strong on 2001? So there's the final chapter card, Jupiter and Beyond, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you got the whole light tunnel and the eyeballs and all the photography and all the photographic tricks, and then, of course, these. Okay. You can do it on YouTube. Somebody has an HD version, so you don't have to sync it up anymore. But much like people would sync up Wizard of Oz and Dark Side of the Moon, which works, it's fine. I see. You got to work a little bit. You don't have to work at all when you put the second side of Pink Floyd's Metal Echoes, starting right as soon as the Jupiter and Beyond title goes off, and cue it up.
It works.
Unbelievable, including the very final crash of the song. when Kubrick's name comes up.
Okay,
boom! I mean, it finishes so strong. And it really is better than that weird music that they have in the movie.
Or it's the dialogue.
Yes. Nobody's favorite. Or no. The dialogue. There's no dialogue in there. Yeah.
No, the classical music, I mean, it's fascinating, but it does detract. But in Barry Lyndon, the classical music does not detract.
Oh, no. Because that's really classical.
That's like period music.
Yeah, exactly.
That's proper period music.
Yeah, no, but the only track that nobody listened to on the 2001 soundtrack is the Jupiter and Beyond music. It's that weird music, right? That's not the good... Yeah, exactly. That's not the good stuff. Yeah. We all like the also Rock of Zarathustra and all that stuff. Yeah,
right.
But not the music at the end.
Now, was that part of not to get into too much of this, about this movie, but was that little bit was that part of the original soundtrack that Kubrick cut? Because I know there was a whole soundtrack written for
Alex
that movie.
North did
Alex North, right? Was that part of that?
I don't know.
Because I wonder if Stanley Kubrick went, I'm cutting out everything you did in the last month for my movie, but I will keep that track.
I know, I don't
even... So shut up, Alex. I mean,
even that is not an Alex North track, I don't think. Yeah.
Something else?
Which, we had a composer on the show last week and revealed that that Alex North was forced on Kubrick. He never wanted to use Alex North's score.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's right, our guest last week.
Yeah, I never realized that. Yeah.
Most people don't know that, well, when they see all his movies, they just assume that he's British.
I know.
Is this New Yorker? He's just a New Yorker.
Somebody just posted a whole hour long
Stanley
interview.
Kubrick talks like this.
Exactly.
That's how he's right. And hey, here's what's going to happen. Barry. So Barry Lyndon comes on a fucking room.
It's so shocking.
It's so shocking. And the other thing is, too, most people don't know that Merchant Ivory are neither one of them are British.
No shit. That surprises me.
Really? That's
no,
really
I can't remember which is which. One's an American.
Ismail Merchant.
Merchant is
doesn't
the dick.
Sound.
Ivory's pretty cool.
One of them, I think, is. Is originally from India, so it speaks with a little bit of a British accent, but he's not British. The other dude's an American.
Hmm. How disappointing.
Now listen, here's how we're going to make these goddamn British pictures, you see?
You come in and you
bring
them tea.
You put the funny little accent, you bring them tea, whatever the fuck you British people do. Speak with that funny little way, and then we'll shoot the damn...
Put in your head that you're going to die by 35, because we're in a cold-ass country, and you went to sleep in the room with no heat.
But I think... But it's funny, like, all those Merchant Ivory movies,
very British movies.
Yeah. I think that foreign directors have a better take on other cultures. You know what I mean? Like, of our most American-looking movies are directed by foreigners.
12 Years a Slave, which I haven't seen yet, but from the accolades it's getting, that's a British director.
I did not know that.
And I wonder if you have to be... And a British star. And an Irish star, Michael Fassbender. I wonder if you have to be kind of removed from it all to not have a certain take on the history in the U.S. or a certain, maybe, misinformation about the history of the U.S.
Yeah, you might. Like, I don't know if you have to, but I think it does lend a unique... Like, what's a good example? What's his name? Michael Curtiz.
Oh.
Perfect example.
Oh.
If you watch all those Bogart movies that he directed, you go, how could an American not know what this guy's about? Come on. Bogart's, American New Yorker. I mean, but he looks like, you can't believe Curtiz, but no, Curtiz would look like this.
Where was Curtiz from?
I think he was from like Romania or something. I can't remember.
Do you do any other directors? Because I love the director impression.
That's
no, but I had no idea you were such an impressionist.
I'm just guessing.
Fred Travellina, look out.
Michael Curtiz. But Michael Curtiz, like all men of his time, was a terrible, I think he was just a terrible racist man. There's a lot of stories about he was infamously racist.
You should tell them now.
Yeah, but was that crazy back
then?
Can
I? I guess I can tell. Well, no, I read a biography. I was reading a biography about, it was written by a famous DP at the time. I can't remember his name, but he was telling me a Curtiz story. He was telling a Curtiz story in this book. And I guess right after Gone with the Wind came out, everybody was making plantation pictures for like 10 minutes, thinking that was going to get them the
Oscar.
That
was the new 3D.
Well, it was going to, everybody wanted the Oscar. So I can't remember what studio he was working for. It might have been Warner's, but I don't know. But making some low-budget plantation picture. I'm not sure you can make a low-budget plantation picture.
Yeah.
But he was, and in this DP was saying, telling the story. He there were a lot of African-Americans as extras, of course, and so he said, you niggers in the back move to the front, and you niggers in the front move farther to the back.
Oh, my God.
So the first AD came up to him and said, Michael, nobody calls them that word anymore. It's deeply, deeply offensive.
God.
They're called colored people. They're not called that. Of course, that was the nomenclature for African Americans.
That was PC.
PC. So he said, okay, you colored niggers in the front, move to the... I mean, he was terrible. He didn't care. God. I think he knew exactly what he was saying, and he was just an awful man. That said, he's a pretty good director, but I mean, otherwise, he's just a monster. You know, I think he was just a monster. Terrible thing. But true story.
I want to do a whole special about the filthy, racist, you know, horrible directors. David Lean?
Question, and then we have yet to discuss this film in the room. Has everyone here seen Birth of a Nation?
Sure, that terrible.
You've never seen Birth of a Nation. Okay, you have.
Amazing for its film technique, but awful in
the most racist thing on the planet.
Awful.
And this is, and what's so funny about it, what people don't realize, people say various things about it. What they don't realize is the movie for the first 45 an hour is just the Civil War, right?
Right.
It's just the Civil War, and it is a great Civil War movie. I mean, they play up the pathos, and they have the families that are ripped apart by the war, and I mean, it's, you know, the winds of war grandiosity, and then the war is over, and then a completely second movie starts where black people take over our government, and they're all sitting around eating watermelon with their feet up on like the senatorial desks and stuff.
Jesus.
I mean, it's like literally
just like the most KKK guys in it.
No, Paul, that's not even it. They come to save the day, and all of D.W. Griffith's like amazing directing is all on display as the KKK rides in like the cowboys to save the girls that are being raped by the blacks who have taken over the United States.
I know. It's unbelievable.
Amazing.
What amazing, crazy, horrifying.
But it's a great movie.
And
directing wise.
Yeah.
They're not wrong. Even the part with the, you know.
I think that's why we sort of are forced to watch that movie, because it's one of the first pictures that has, I think, close ups and medium shots.
It was one of the first movies you
watched. Parallel editing, too, with the people coming and the people.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
But it's the first movie you're told to watch it when you're a film student. We watched it in college.
It's the film that totally canonized how American movies would be made forever, which is disguising cuts.
That's what I'm saying. I think it's hilarious that's the subject matter for the most groundbreaking film since Nanook of the North.
It is a film school of
canon.
Of how you do
racism.
That. Of racism as well.
But you know what's kind of great? I saw a remake of 12 Angry Men. It was a TV made for TV movie made in 97, directed by William Friedkin.
What? William Friedkin did a 12 Angry Men?
He certainly did, and it was made in 97.
I'd see that.
And good. But it was great because they recast it. It was half African American now, the cast, in this version I saw, and it works great. Believe it, it works great. Like because the subject matter is racism. But it works great because, I mean, all these people are now racist against somebody else. Mm. But it was fascinating and kind of great and well cast. Well, worth seeing. George C. Scott in the Lee J. Cobb role. So it worked really, really good.
97, so that's from the director of Jade at that time, right?
Yes.
Rules of Engagement.
Rules of Engagement. Which, actually, I kind of like that movie. I
like that, too.
I enjoyed it. But it was weird. That famous movie was originally a TV movie, which they released as a movie and then remade into a TV movie. It's so weird. Hmm. Now the subject of 10,000 high school plays.
Yeah, but the original who directed the original? Wasn't that Sidney Lumet?
I think it was Sidney Lumet.
I've never seen it, but I'm a huge Lumet fan.
Me too.
Going back to what you claim to be your favorite genre, what's your favorite horror film then of all time?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man, favorite horror film. Well, that's tough. I would... all the way through, man. I don't know. I just know movies that I keep.
Is it because you know there's a wrong answer? I shouldn't have put that pressure on
you. No. It's not just a wrong answer. I'm not a big traditional horror movie guy in terms of like movie monsters and vampires and stuff like that. I like things modern day horror, which is like war and movies about what we. I think just modern day horror stuff. I like thought provoking sort of horror movies. Like I like right now I'm watching a lot of The Beast, which is
That's Afghanistan.
Yeah,
was it Jason Patrick?
William Mastrantonio wrote the play for. George, how do you pronounce his name?
Zunda?
Zunda, I think it's Zunda.
Zunda.
Yeah. And he's great. And that's a completely horrifying movie.
He was in movies from 95 to 96.
I do like, but on the classic sense, I do like Cat People a lot.
Which
that
one?
Movie's really the original one.
The original,
The original one. I love that movie. It's so upsetting. And
now, which one's the original one?
That's the Jacques Tournier.
What year?
That's, I don't know. 40. 50? About 50?
50?
Okay.
50? I don't know.
So it wasn't 53?
Might be 53. It
wasn't the one in 86 that I watched on HBO a lot?
No.
Okay.
No.
That's 82, and that I completely fell in love with Natasha Kinski.
Natasha Kinski, yeah.
She's so
sure?
pretty in that movie.
Sure.
Oh, my God.
Boing.
But yeah. It just happens to be kind of a weird kind of great movie, but what I loved about it, I mean, and also, he, Tournay pioneered the shock scare noise. It was before Tournay. They didn't have quiet. Dun, dun, dun. Oh. They didn't have that cats jumping out. He did all that.
Although in his movie, I guess it was cats jumping out. Maybe he invented the cat scare.
He might have invented the cat scare. I mean, he took.
They were using puppies before then.
They were.
There's no it's just a cat. It's holy shit. It's a cat.
Well, I know he took. He was taking that sort of German expressionist look, but then updating it with an American pacing. You know what I mean? It was like snappy as opposed to like Euro boring, you know, so it made it very cool.
Do you, at Halloween time, do you like pack up the horror movies? Like I get obsessed for like the 2 weeks before Halloween, just nothing, horror movies after horror movie.
Oh, it's
so great to have a fest and to pull the lights out and it's so great.
Well, I get hung up, like I don't get any work done because every channel's like, Scary Monday. So I go, I got to watch all those.
I'm not going anywhere.
Yeah, movies. I got to watch,
Monday's shut.
Yeah, I've got to watch Leprechaun 9. I have to watch that.
Gosh, I hope they don't have Spooky Tuesday, otherwise I'm never going to get anything
Tentacles.
Done.
I think Leprechaun's the funniest franchise ever made. I don't know if there's another long, long-running franchise which is trying to be funny and horror at the same time.
Oh, yeah.
This lasted so long. There wasn't originally intention to be parody.
Leprechaun?
It wasn't initially a parody. It was supposed to be. It's supposed to be a little silly, but it wasn't. Yeah. It wasn't like the Scream movies.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? But it was like it was just its own weird vibe. And then it became absurd. But
Child's Play made a good move with that. Child's Play made a great move to move completely to comedy by the fourth movie.
Yes.
The Son of Chucky and the Bride of Chucky.
Right, but that was done really well.
Very, very well done.
They did it really well, yeah.
But what's really funny is because I watched all those for this last Halloween. Those were all shown on one of the Fear Net or something like that. And once you watch The Seed of Chucky and The Bride of Chucky, and I watch them kind of out of order and stuff, and then watch the original. But then you're just like, hey, by three, it is hard to believe they're taking themselves seriously still. You're like, you don't realize this is just not that not that great anymore. But luckily they clearly realized it and moved on.
Yeah.
So this also did a good job, I think, of combining horror and comedy.
It's only been a few hours since I've translated and spoken aloud the first of the demon resurrection passages from the Book of the Dead.
The Evil Dead, of course.
Evil Dead, yeah.
Yes.
No. How old were you when Sam shot Evil Dead?
The first one?
Yeah.
I was 13 or 14.
Wow. Oh, wow. Were you able to go watch it be shot at all? Or?
Yeah, my parents thought it'd be a good idea for me to go. They wanted me to go down to to Tennessee, to be with my brother for a couple of reasons. One, they thought it'd be good for me.
Yeah.
Just to go see how something's done and how something's built. But also, so they flew me down there. So they flew me down there, but then also they wanted me to check up on Sam to make sure he wasn't, killing himself.
Because it was cold and rainy and wet and why did they shoot in Tennessee?
So send the 13-year-old to make sure everything's okay.
I think I was 14. It might have been about 14. Well, they were going to shoot in Michigan, but it was just too. They were shooting in the wintertime, so they wanted a warmer climate.
Yeah.
So they wound up going to Tennessee to sort of sub for Michigan. Those woods, we don't have Appalachians in Michigan, so it looks a little weird. All those mountains, It's like, I didn't know there were 150-foot cliffs off of Michigan. There aren't. But when I got off the plane. Sam greeted me and he was like, "How you doing?" I went, "Great. How's mom and dad?" "Great. They give you any money?" I have like $100 to spend over this week. This was back in, '79. $100 was like $200 or something. I was like, it's just for my food and stuff. He goes, "Let me have it." I go, "Why?" He goes, "I'm broke. If you don't give it to me, we're not going to eat." I went, all right, I guess I'm doing that. So I was like totally broken, you know. Then I'm like,
welcome to Hollywood.
Just eating crap. I mean, the worst, nastiest craft service, you know. But I didn't know any better. I was like, I guess this food's free, so I'll eat it. But it was pretty frightening.
So you fed the crew of Evil Dead. Or your mom did, I guess.
No, technically, yeah. I mean, I don't know.
Well, you got a producer credit out of it, right? Because you were financing it now.
Technically,
that's how
yes.
it works.
Yeah. No, it works the way it happened to me, which is you finance it, but you don't get credit.
And you get shaken down
and
for your money.
And you get shaken down for your money. Yeah.
Oh, go ahead. No, I think I remember from the commentary track, aren't you like the, when there's like severed hands and feet, is that you or something?
Yeah, Evil Dead? That's
yeah,
right.
I think I remember hearing that was you. One really funny thing, I think, about the fact that and you're in Evil Dead 2 where you play Henrietta, the possessed insane.
Right.
Yeah.
Sure.
What's so funny about it is such a brotherly thing to like torture your little brother like that. It's so funny. It's like just beat you up, make you like go under the floorboards of a cabin and stick your feet through and stay there for hours, take your money and then dress you in like 1,000 pounds of
stick
latex.
A bunch of, yeah, plaster on your face.
Sure.
It's such a brotherly relationship.
Oh, you know, I mean, it was fine. I mean, I was grateful that I could get my SAG card. That's how I ultimately got my SAG card. I thought it would be really easy. I thought, well, all I have to do is put this costume on and it'll give me my SAG card. That was going to be the easiest way to get my SAG card. It was like the fucking hardest way in the world.
You had to prove that was you or what?
No, it was just because normally actors come on and they go, yes, I did it. I killed John Robbins. Great. Okay, get your SAG card. Go on. First AD, he'll take care of you. Walk to your trailer. You're wrapped. That's it. Ah, I'm a SAG actor. For me, it was like, okay, now your day starts at 3. You get makeup put on until 8 o'clock, out on the set at 9, full costume, full body makeup. The set was like 95 degrees. Inside the costume was like 110 degrees. So wow. I did that for weeks, you know, and I was like, this is the dumbest idea I ever had in my life. But I had a great time making it, and it with the crew and the rest of the cast was great, and you know, at very least, it would be the equivalent of if you're an architect and your first job as an architect is to basically, you know, dig out a latrine at the base of your new dig site. And then you go, wow, there's nothing hard about being an architect at all. And that's sort of how I felt about that. It was the first big job I had. It was the hardest thing I've ever done. You know, I don't think actors ever have to do anything that hard. I had an oxygen tank, for Christ's sakes. You know, like between takes,
yeah,
I was breathing out of an oxygen tank so I wouldn't pass out.
Yeah,
but I thought that that's just what it was. I didn't really know any better, and so. But when I got through with it, you know, I would do other horror movies.
Sam's not going to tell you.
No, and I would do other horror movies, and they'd go, hey, you might have to put a little blood on you. Is that okay? And they were like really cautious because I know actors, you know, because a lot of actors freak out if they get like any sticky and red and crap put on them and stuff. You know, that isn't like a Sunday or something. So, but yeah. So
well, you had to do that because you weren't, you didn't have the other option available to you that most people engage when they get their SAG card, which is just to blow the director. So
no, I didn't have that option.
That's awkward.
Very awkward. I did not. But at that point, I'd already been working though too, and so yeah. I mean, I knew I didn't have my SAG card, but I'd already been doing a lot of non-union stuff for like GM and Chrysler and Ford and stuff like that.
Oh yeah, you started acting in like industrials or commercials
yeah, a lot
in
of them.
Detroit.
Lots and lots of them. Yeah, I kind of cut my teeth in that, you know, delivering lines, doing that. I did a ton of them. Then and it was great because in Detroit back in those days, this was like, you know, 1987, 1988, mm-hmm. there were only, I would only go up against like four or five other guys.
Because there's not any
actors in Detroit, but there's a lot of stuff to shoot. So it was great.
Huh.
And I was used so much that, and there was such a small acting pool that I remember one week I did a commercial for GM about how great they were to the union, an industrial film. And then another week, a UAW spot about how shitty GM was to them. They were both going to completely separate audiences. God. Yeah, and they were both, you know, I mean, they were both of, and that what was hilarious is that it was just the hypocrisy on both sides was absurd because they were both saying how sweet and gentle they were, and meanwhile, all these lunches was like crack crab from Italy and crap. Both, I mean, it's UAW too. I mean, they had plenty of dough. It was hilarious. I mean, it just
that's amazing.
Yeah,
that's a true Detroit story.
Yeah,
Detroit
really,
acting story.
Yeah, it was great. I mean, I did a ton of those, and it was great. I mean,
well, I'm sure you didn't contribute to the craft service of this. when you played this part, let's play a little highlights from.
He's got these clips.
He's got clips. Spider-Man. He's got Ted clips.
Ted Raimi. This is your life.
Hoffman?
Yeah?
Oh. We have a page one problem. Shut up.
They're really important clients. They can't wait.
They're about to.
Mr. Jameson, it's like this. We double book page six. See, so both Macy's and Conway's both have three quarters of the same.
Move Conway to page seven.
There's a problem with page
seven. I make it page eight and give them 10% off. Okay. I make it 5%.
That can't be done.
Get out of here. Hoffman! Yeah. What are we going to call this guy?
Dr. Octopus.
That's crap. Wait, I got it. Dr. Octopus.
I like it.
Of course you do. What are you looking for, a raise? Get out.
So those were great. It was wonderful. Those movies were great fun to act with J.K. Simmons.
Oh,
you know,
God. Those,
it was like doing old school movie comedy.
It is. That's totally classic comedy. Right?
This is not the first time we've played J. Jonah Jameson clips on the show. He just cracks us up. We constantly are playing and
yelling and screaming.
That's great.
I mean, but you know, I guess playing idiots when I do comedy, playing idiots, my forte. You know, that's what I do best. So,
but it's just perfect in that sort of My Fair Lady style of just the fast dialogue. And I mean, I said this to Paul earlier today over email. Forget Ben Affleck or forget whoever's being cast. Did they just cast Wonder Woman? Right?
Mm-hmm, they did.
Oh, they did.
They did. She's also going to be in the Batman Superman movie. I say go for it. I love how the Avengers has made everyone all nervous. And they're like, we have to put every superhero in a movie. Like, yes. If they overreach, it'll be an awesome overreach.
I can't wait to see who plays the Flash.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's a TV show. Anyway, the point is, you get me caught on superheroes. But I say, you know, forget Ben Affleck. No character will ever be adapted from the comics better than J. Jonah Jameson. You just can't.
No, they did a great job casting him, and he was perfect. You know, and what a great career he's had so far too. I mean, he's from that character in Oz, not the movie of the TV show. You know, he's that terrible racist guy, and then he goes to playing that goof, and then he's whatever, what's her face's dad in that pregnancy
Juno.
Movie?
Juno, fantastic in that movie.
You know, so he's played him. He does everything. You know?
He was the only highlight for me in Burn After Reading.
And Lady,
he
Killers.
Was good.
Yeah,
I did not see that movie.
You're lucky.
I missed that movie.
Burn After Reading.
Yeah.
I hear that's one of those Coen things where you watch it the second time, you're like, oh no, it's brilliant. Sorry, I thought it was bad.
I mean,
does that happen sometimes?
I gotta give it that second view.
Yeah, that's where I can't get to. I can't get to actually sitting down and watching it a second time.
Yeah.
But Lady Killers, he's great too. So he showed up in.
He was in Burn After Reading, right?
And David Rashi,
yes.
in Second City, which I love seeing him.
He was Sledgehammer, right?
Sledgehammer.
Love that.
Did you watch Sledgehammer?
No, I never watched Sledgehammer, but I did. But I did. What was that? Sitcom.
Like
what was it about?
85. But yeah, it was like
detective.
Making fun of Dirty Harry.
Yeah.
Like he was always pulling his gun and shooting things and blowing things up and messing things up.
So it was a Dirty Harry
office ball.
Total like police squad version of Dirty Harry.
Oh, okay. Right. No, I did not see that, but I loved Get Smart.
Ah, yes.
They should make a new version of that, just something new. Do they have anything like that now?
They tried, right?
No, they did Steve Carell, yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't see it.
No, a TV show version?
Oh, no, that was a movie.
No, it would be great. A TV show, a funny...
Adams, he was a funny
The funniest show I've ever,
ever
seen in the world.
I mean, of course,
Police
it had to be. That had to be Mel... Yeah, that was awesome.
I mean, 8 episodes or something crazy.
Police
Far too
squad.
Few.
What funny... show?
Police Squad.
Oh, Police Squad. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Minute for minute, some of the funniest comedy that's
I don't
ever
know why that
here.
Show just
like
100 belly
jokes
flopped.
A half
I don't
hour.
Know.
Yeah.
It's because, like, Zucker hadn't made, like, 9 million movies at that point. It only made, like, 3 or something. I don't know. Like, that wasn't enough.
I bet you do a good Don Adams.
That's a dare.
I don't know. I don't know if I can do Don Adams.
Oh, okay.
Missed it by that. No, that was me.
That's close.
They call me the Craw. The Craw? Not the Craw. The Craw! The Craw? Those were great, and I mean, it did take a guy like Mel Brooks to put something like that together. Though.
Yeah,
I mean, of course, it's going to be, just totally inappropriate humor, but still funny after all these years. I mean, just absurd. I think there's, it's funny. Like, I think Brooks is probably past the point where he can let himself not make racist jokes. I don't know if he's capable of it.
He's no Michael Curtiz.
Yeah, I don't think he's any Michael Curtiz. Thank God. Nobody is like Michael Curtiz. God, I don't know if that, man, that would happen today. That guy would rightly get lynched.
Well, there'd be video of it.
Unbelievable. Yeah, there'd
be
video.
There'd be some extra with a camera.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. But anyway, yes, so continue.
My next question is, in lieu of Karen not being here, she would want me to ask, because you were in Stuart Saves His Family.
She
finds that one of the most underrated films of all time.
And so do I.
Okay,
so do I.
I wanted to get your opinion. You think so as well?
Yeah, I do too. And Harold Ramis directed it, and Al Franken was in it. And that movie got so lambasted by the critics. That was, well, just a side note before I continue. On my resume, it's just so happens I was in one of the top 10 highest grossing films of all time, which is Spider-Man 2. Mm-hmm. In addition, I was in, as far as major movie releases of all time, in the one of the bottom 10 flops of all time, which is Stuart Saves His Family. And I think it was made for 24 million or something like this, maybe a little more than that. Sorry, we had some big star power in that. Maybe 30 something, and I think it grossed under something like I don't know, $35,000, $50,000. It was a serious flop. Some of it was a releasing too. I think the studio felt it was so bad they just kind of shuffled it out the door in a couple theaters and then dumped it. But yeah, I thought it was terrific.
Unjustly,
it's
so.
A very sweet movie.
Yeah, absolutely.
I only had a little part in it, but I felt very grateful that I was in that thing, and I really enjoyed Harold Ramis and.
So you get to get directed by Harold Ramis.
Yeah, it was great. You know, he's just such a comic genius. You know,
who are your favorite directors you've been directed by? You've been directed by so many.
Well, you know, I think out of my favorites,
the fact that you haven't mentioned,
yeah.
Your brother right away.
Oh, yeah. Sure. Oh, well, no, of course. I was working with Sam. I do. I don't consider him like some strange, weird dude that I work yeah. with. So it didn't come to mind
yeah,
right away.
He already had an opinion on Sam when Sam directed him.
I had an opinion on him when I was born.
He
shook me down for $100.
Other
come
than
on.
Sam.
I liked working a lot with Wes Craven.
Oh,
I enjoyed working with Wes Craven a lot. He was interesting. You know, Wes is an interesting guy because... He's the most underdirected. He's one of the most under. I like working with directors who don't seem directory. They take you by surprise as an actor. You know, you are thrown to left field very quickly and frequently after that because you don't think they're going to be giving you direction, but they always do. Wes appears to be a substitute college history professor.
Oh,
he's the guy who comes in with the, you know, the goatee and the, you know, and the brown patches, which is what he looks like when he walks on set. And you think he's the guy who goes, "Now, what page were you all on?" He's that guy. That's his vibe, you know? And you go, I can't believe this guy is like this incredibly brilliant horror director. The other guy who I loved being directed by was Toby Hooper.
Oh,
And Toby. Toby's another one that comes out of left field, and he's really, really good with actors. You wouldn't think.
What film was it?
Yeah, what's he?
Oh, I did a Showtime movie for him a few years ago.
Masters of Horror.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that series.
And Toby's it's just kind of an old Texas hippie now. Yeah. Was a young Texas hippie when he made Texas Chainsaw, but you know, Toby talks like this, man.
Really?
He comes in,
oh my God.
Hey, here's an idea. You're gonna walk in there. And whenever Toby really liked something, he'd go, way cool, man. Yeah, way cool. So he was, you know, he's the guy who you can't, now he's, you know, some kind of a Texas hick. He is not, you know. He is highly sophisticated, very smart man. That said, he does look a little bit like the dude you buy beer from near Waco, Texas. he is a little bit like that, you know. Yeah, he's a little bit. So he totally takes you by surprise, but his direction is astute. He's got a really great control and a great vision about what his stuff should look like and sees it through. He's an interesting guy. So I enjoyed working with him, too, you know.
Yeah, I think Poltergeist.
Mike Nichols was cool too. I enjoyed Mike Nichols was a he was.
Legend.
I mean, yeah. I mean, you know. I also when I auditioned for, I was one of my first movies I ever did. I was only like 20.
Which movie of his?
Postcards from the Edge.
Oh,
I have one line. I have one line with Meryl Streep in that movie. That's it. I'm this stupid orderly at a hospital, and I say what. That's all I said.
Here's your sidecar.
But you got to watch Mike Nichols
direct. That was a lot easier, huh?
What's that?
But you got to watch Mike Nichols direct.
I got to watch Mike Nichols direct.
And
Second City, all those comedy albums. I used to own all of them.
Yes.
Like Elaine May.
Amazing.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Amazing.
They were so funny. I'd listen to them again. And then when I met him, I didn't even think of his face. I was just thinking of that voice. You know, he's got that voice, Mike Nichols, you know, he kind of sounds like this. You know, he's just got that, I don't know, he's got this sonorous voice,
That is an amazing thing, the sound of that voice. When I met Dan Aykroyd, I was so shocked to hear Dan Aykroyd's voice come out of him. But I don't know why I should be. Obviously, it's going to, but that it's such a particular voice.
But it comes out of a movie screen. It doesn't come out of a guy.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Right? Same thing with Mike Nichols. You're like, oh, it's Mike Nichols' voice coming out of, well, Mike Nichols, but of course. But
I mean, the, you know, I mean, of course, obviously The Graduate and all that stuff. But that aside, you know, it's, I just kept thinking about those brilliant comedy albums. I just listen to him 1,000 times over.
I could watch the first half hour of The Graduate over and over and over, and often do. I mean, he just he directed the whole thing well, but there's some crafting in that first half hour that I just can go on.
Not the least
on
of which, about. Dustin Hoffman is the ultimate wasp.
Oh.
I don't know if anybody else could have gotten away with that acting wise or directing wise. It's just it's too weird, but well, it kind of weirdly works.
Yeah, that
why.
Was a huge like fight that Nichols had to put up for that, right?
Yeah,
because
I would imagine.
You got Dustin Hoffman playing a wasp.
Do we know who? I can't remember the story, but
you know,
who
it's
they
like,
originally cast.
It's like, and you know, and Jackie Mason as John F. Kennedy. It's like, what? I'm sorry, who are you casting as what?
Jackie,
I'm the president. The president of the United States of America. I don't want to go to Texas. I might get shot. I might get sit in the car. I want to be there, Mister. Why do I have to go? I don't like eating pigs' legs. I don't know what that is.
Jews don't go to Dallas.
Jews don't go to Dallas.
They don't go to Texas.
We don't want those ones.
But it is a weird piece of casting putting him in that. It was just absolutely bizarre.
Yeah, well, that's just one of those choices, and you know, Nichols had to fight for that. Nobody wanted that, and so you're like, man, how did he just knew that this would all work. I mean, obviously, you know, you recognize that Dustin Hoffman's talented, but sticking to your guns to that degree, you know,
and if you're listening and you're going,
legendary
the guy from Meet the Fockers? No, okay, go back, watch The Graduate, Little Big Man, Midnight Cowboy, and watch the range in those three performances within that happened within like 5 years or less.
Yeah,
he's amazing. Dustin Hoffman is
he
amazing.
Is amazing, still is amazing. Yeah. I, you know, it's funny just thinking back to like, you know, do directors get to pick and fight, or is it better to have producers tell them? And you can, and this argument goes back and forth 1,000 times. Producers like to cite the fact they'd like to go back 30, 40 years, 50 years to when they made all the decisions, directors made none of them. Casting-wise, or almost none of them. Yeah. Those movies, on the whole, were very successful. The studios did very, very, very well. But the difference is that in those days, those guys like, you know, Lemley and Warner Brothers and all those guys, they started out as theater owners. They sat in the theaters and watched all the movies come in. They knew year in, year out, being in the audience, watching all those movies, exactly what audience members like to see.
Interesting.
But MBAs do not have that.
Huh.
So I don't know. I mean, I think it's half, maybe half and half. I don't know what the, I don't know. But I certainly, the reason, part of the reason those guys were able to pick such great, great guys, why guys like, you know, Jack Warner was able to find, you know, a Bogart and a Cagney and stuff is because they were sitting in their own crappy theaters in New York back in the 20s going, well, that actor's good, that actor's bad. This audience likes this, the audience doesn't like that.
Yeah, interesting.
Yeah, I think a practical experience matters a lot.
I want to move on to what did you see this week? But do you have another question?
I had a couple more, but yeah, I can ask them after. Well, first of all, this question comes from my sister, Jessie. She is 18 years younger than me, but we have the exact same tastes in horror and indie film and everything like that. She, there is a Candyman remake coming out, and she wanted to know if a certain hunky biker would be showing back up in Candyman.
A hunky biker. I know. I don't think I'm going to be in that movie, but at least not that I know of. But the answer is I don't know. I think it's worthy of a remake. It's a pretty timeless story.
Yeah.
And Bernard Rose, I think, made it into something really, really unique. And he's a great director. And I hope whoever they got directing this thing is going to be as good.
Yeah. No, that was one of those horror movies where you're like, oh, the director is taking this very seriously and not just trying to knock one out. Down to the music by
Philip Glass.
In any other horror movie?
I don't know how he pulled that off. I don't know how
and
he
it's
pulled
a great
that
score.
Off.
Did not know that.
It is a great score. I remember when he bagged him, and that I remember Bernard talking to him at a party, and before 2 months before the movie came out, and he went, that's how he loved to laugh, Bernard. do you know who I've got for the? You know who I've got? Philip Glass. You know, he was like clapping. He's just so excited, and I went, did you just say Philip Glass?
Philip Glass, as in?
I was like, how did that happen? Not that Bernard is not a without his charms, but it is a horror movie, and Philip Glass is Philip Glass.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But, you know, there it goes.
What a great choice.
It was a crazy score.
What's your favorite awesome. Twilight Zone episode?
Wow, that's a tough one. I would say maybe kick the can, perhaps, or Terror at 35,000 Feet.
That's a great one.
That's an awesome one.
Of course.
I don't think there's one that completely sucks.
Yeah.
So that's kind of like going, you know, what's your favorite color M&M? I mean, it's like, well, I guess green or red, but they're all pretty freaking good.
I just saw a new one, and I was gotten a kick where every morning I woke up and I watched a Twilight Zone episode. Oh, it was Halloween. Usually I wake up and watch a cartoon in the morning.
Yeah.
That's just how I set my day. But at Halloween, I was like, it doesn't feel right watching cartoons. Yeah, so I picked a Twilight Zone to watch every day. Saw one. It was great. It begins on a ship in World War II, and a guy realizes that the ship is going to be bombed
the U-boat
by some
commander.
U-boat commander.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He tries to tell everybody on the ship.
I think Serling wrote that one.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure he did.
Serling, what a genius.
He wrote about half of them.
That's an amazing amount of output.
Yeah, he just reintroduced me to it being on Netflix. Ooh,
yeah.
No.
Oh, yeah.
Just
yeah,
hit
yeah.
Netflix, start watching yeah. Twilight Zones.
But that's
if
a great one.
A
yeah, I mean, he had a story that informed his whole life. And this story, if I tell, when
Serling?
I tell you, yeah, that would not be surprising at all. Which was this: during World War II, he was, you know, one of these. He was in the Pacific Theater and the Navy, and he was one of these poor schmoes who was. They took some crap island, a small one, fairly unimportant, but they sent him and like maybe 30 other guys in a little patrol to go just guard it for
wow.
about a month.
Huh.
So they had to be there for a month just sitting there with, you know, their, you know, Garand rifles just waiting for in case any Japanese came by.
Wow.
So they're holding this island, but they're starting to starve. And they have no communication. They don't have radio.
Whoa.
And they're starving. And, they're down to their last when finally this cargo plane goes over, U.S. cargo plane, and their captain says, Serling, you and your buddy, who was his best friend since childhood, get up on that hill, guide the plane, put flares and smoke, make sure they drop at the right place. So they do, and they do drop at the right place, but the crate of food they were waiting for lands right on his friend and kills him.
Oh. Whoa.
And he said that informed his whole life. And, I mean, it's not surprising. That's much like a Twilight Zone episode. It's just it's the ultimate sort of absurdity that the thing they were waiting for, it wasn't a soldier, it wasn't the war at all. It was just bad luck.
Life-giving food that crushed his friend and killed him.
Yeah, exactly. You're going to starve and die, and finally the food's here.
Yeah,
and you die.
That really happened.
Boy,
to
that
him
is a Twilight Zone.
Yeah, and you know, and it's not surprising too. He came from this little upstate New York town, and hence the name of his company, you know, Cayuga Productions.
Cayuga.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So many of his stories are about going back to little towns.
Hmm.
Which I think
and something weird happens. Also, not unlike what upstate New York.
Yes. Either you go back and you do something, or you go back and you die, or you go back and you're young
yeah,
again,
yeah.
You go back and something happens.
There's Journey on the radio and it's 2012. You're trying to figure out what the hell.
There's Journey on the radio?
Yes,
like the band Journey?
Yeah. Every time I go back to upstate, my family's actually
you're
from
upstate.
You're
basically going
well.
Back in time
it's
now if you go
back
to upstate.
Yes. You're like, why is REO Speedwagon in heavy rotation here? What's going on?
What's going on? Picture a man.
you're in Kingston, New York. Oh, okay, that explains it. Yeah.
All right, I want to fire up another version of...
What did you see?
I love this. This is great.
So yeah, that theme song is on the fence. What do you think? You like it?
I love it.
Right.
See,
I love it. I love it that it's short and that it's over.
I feel bad I didn't get you a theme song.
No, I'm kidding. I do love it. I'm just teasing. Actually, I'm jealous because it's really pretty cute.
He brought his own.
No. But the main question of the theme, of course, is what did you see this week?
Yeah, you're asking me. I took the train. LA has a public transportation. For those of you who don't live here,
thought
really
we voted that down.
I know it, but it really is here. And I took the train from my home here in Toluca Lake to Koreatown, and there I saw a movie called 11 a.m.
11 a.m.
Which was very confusing walking into the movie because the movie started at 2. So I say, is this the 2 o'clock, 11 a.m.? The theater guy went, thought a minute. He went, yes. But it was. And it's a Korean movie. It's a time travel movie.
Oh.
It's a sci-fi horror picture.
Ooh.
About of course, it's a time machine movie, and a man and a group of people on this, it's a very strange plot, manning and monitoring an underwater nuclear station, which is strange, but it's true. They need the power of this nuclear generator to test this time machine. They do, but in doing so, they trigger this terrible loop that they all have to keep living through.
Oh,
it's a very
wow.
strange, awesome, kind of weird horror picture. So that's what I
that
saw.
That starts at 11 a.m.
Groundhog Day.
I'd just be
but in that. A terrible, terrible way. It's a great idea.
Oh, wow.
Super
cool. An experiment
cool.
triggers the effect, and then they just...
They must keep reliving this terrible, terrible day, and there's no way out of it. I don't know what it is about the, some Asian movies. Asian horror movies are very interesting in that very seldomly do people deserve to die, but they do. Like, it's weird. Like, we do have an old school sort of puritanical idea here in horror movies that you first must do something bad, and because of your actions, the universe will, or God or whatever, will destroy you with a, you know,
yeah.
Or kill you or cause you to suffer in some way if you don't die. But in so many Asian movies I see that are, have horror elements in it, you just die because you're in the wrong place at the wrong time. You're just standing under the wrong place, and then you just get either possessed or zapped back in time or just
squished by
luck.
Godzilla.
Yakuza just yeah. takes you out.
Yeah. yeah, it's very interesting. But anyway, that's what I saw. You guys?
No, I'm going to answer real quickly because I saw a movie and I can't remember what it was, but it either had Vince Vaughn or Kevin James. It had something to do with this holidays. A lesson was learned. Greed was the theme, and they went home. Fill in the blanks.
Who was in it?
I can't. It was one of those.
Doesn't matter. That's like 100 different movies.
Yeah, it was on TV.
You saw a holiday movie.
I saw a holiday movie, yes.
That's okay. Holiday movies are nice.
Oh, I'm all about it.
I'm a fan of holiday movies.
Yeah, it's pretty exciting.
I like holiday movies.
It's the only holiday with so much content. I mean, horror movies we've adopted because it's Halloween, but it's not like there was a holiday and then people were like, oh, we're going to make movies for that holiday. The genre exists. But for Halloween, it's got its own content.
That's
and
right.
songs, too. It's the only holiday with just tons of songs. Nobody even holds a candle to it.
To Halloween? Or to Christmas.
To Christmas.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I thought you said about Halloween, too.
It's about his
songs.
It's Halloween time.
The Elfman had a couple.
But, you know, that's true. That's true. You know, and it's timeless.
So
that's a good thing, like, say, D.W. Griffith didn't do a Christmas movie.
D.W. Griffith's A Christmas.
A Christmas, that'd be terrible. You
Negro.
Know, yeah. See.
Tis the season for awards fodder, so I went to see Philomena.
Oh, yeah? Yeah.
And I keep calling that Philomena.
Yeah.
But that's not it, is it?
Yeah, what is it? How do you pronounce it?
Philomena.
Philomena.
It's Judi Dench's character's name, and she is a woman who was in the Magdalene Laundry nightmare that went on in Ireland.
It's a fair one.
And her kid was taken from her by the nuns, and her job, the movie is about her trying to find her kid.
Right.
And in comes Steve Coogan, who I found out produced and wrote the film as well, which... You know,
but
is
it's totally like a
bonus.
Showpiece for Dench. I've heard it's just like
for both of them.
Coogan.
Okay. Although he plays it very low key, he plays a reporter who just really needs a story, and then he hears about this emotional piece or whatever they call it when it's like a story that's like just it's gonna tug your heartstrings. So he's like, I'll look into this story until, of course, he finds it very interesting. They have a great relationship. Kind of becomes a road trip where they set out to meet people and track down her son and. Filled with great humor, and Stephen Frears made it, so it's no joke. He's for real, and
I like him as directing a lot. I love his style.
I just hope it's not too subtle that it gets passed over at awards time because it could certainly get some recognition.
Sounds good. I'd like to see Judi Dench as something other than M.
Yeah. I mean, I got
done with that.
Well, that's a
she's
good
done with that.
It's a good dovetail into what I watched this week, because this week would encompass Thanksgiving weekend as well.
Oh yes,
which traditionally James Bond, of course, is the sci-fi does a whole fest of that. Last year they did a fest of it, and my roommate and I decided, well, we've seen 12 James Bond movies. Why don't we watch the other 11 or whatever? And and proceeded to watch every James Bond movie between
how many are there?
Friday is, I think it's 23. So we watched every James Bond movie last year. So we said, all right, well, this year, let's not do James Bond. Let's still do like a whole day of like a certain genre of movie. And so he said, how about classic westerns? Because he and I were
that's a good one.
Both pretty spotty on like what classics we've seen. We know what the classics are. So we're like, let's just nail all the classics so that we've watched them. And they can be kind of boring, stuff like that. So we watched, and I'm going to miss some here, My Darling Clementine. Man Who Shot Liberty Valance, Dodge City with
wow, those are great.
Do you know
ones.
Dodge City? Who's the guy with the pencil thin mustache? What's his name?
Clark Gable?
Ernie Kovacs?
No, come on.
John Waters.
Clooney,
John Waters was it?
Nah, I can't think of it. Can't think of it right now. One of those hunks founded United Artists. Anyway,
Fairbanks.
Fairbanks.
Oh my God.
Fairbanks,
wow,
only
really?
Western.
In a Western.
One of two, I think. But
weird.
But it's awesome.
Western, yeah.
It's a three strip Technicolor movie because I think it's 39 or something like that. Yeah. So it's got that great color, and it's Fairbanks as a cowboy. And this is not a cowboy. Like, he is the
he's not, still got a sword.
He's absolutely just this dashing man and everything he says. And you're like, y'all could be at the end of one of these sentences. But anyway, but it's just great to see him in a Western. It's really
next thing you know, they'll be casting Charlton Heston as a Mexican.
There you go. Stagecoach, The Searchers, High Noon, and The Professionals with Lee Marvin. And
wow, there, great ones.
I think there was one other one that was a real good surprise was...
Rio Bravo.
Didn't watch Rio Bravo. We had it, but we didn't watch
it's
it.
It's a good one.
And then, yeah, I wanted to get to that one. But that one's 2 hours and like 20 minutes or something. I was like,
When you're doing a full day, you kind of got to
exactly.
go for a real-time High Noon adventure.
Amazing thing was Man Who Shot Liberty Valance.
Fantastic.
I missed that. I did not see that movie.
Oh, you got to see it.
Yeah.
It's where Pilgrim comes from. It's where John Wayne's saying Pilgrim comes from.
Okay.
It's so great because he calls him Pilgrim all the time because he's Jimmy Stewart. And Jimmy Stewart is just...
Everybody do their Wayne.
Oh, you've changed.
I'm not going to hit you. The hell I ain't.
No,
Jordy,
come on. I think...
you and Stinky Pete. You know why he talked like that? Because he smoked so hard, you know, they had to pull a lung out of him.
Oh,
do you know that?
Wow.
Yeah, it's that whole thing.
So it's all inhale.
No, he's trying to catch his breath. That's where that comes from. He didn't make it up. It's, you know, I'm sure at some point, John Wayne probably talked like this at some point. Said, hey, you guys, Shorty, get off of that horse. But because he had a horrible lung removed, because he smoked like 90 packs a day, he was like, now, Shorty, you and Tommy, get over there to that village. And another thing, it's like, come on already.
He was the best in The Greatest Story Ever Told, which was just that Bible story, the Jesus story. It was loaded with, you know,
actors who shouldn't be in that movie.
Yeah, celebrity stars as opposed to. But, right. And he had the last line. And he shouldn't have, you know, like, Jesus on the cross or whatever. And they cut to John Wayne. He's backlit and he says something like, truly, this man is the Son of God.
He did not.
Credits.
That's not true. You're making that up.
Wow.
And then credits start rolling.
Oh,
that's sort of
amazing.
Upsetting. That's amazing and upsetting.
That's awesome.
Oh, but High Noon is on my... This would be a good question.
Finally saw... I was in movie jail for that one.
I was in movie jail, too. That's what movie... I wanted to put this to you.
Oh, yeah.
What movie have you not seen that you should have by now and puts you in movie jail?
Oh.
High Noon is top of my list.
I saw him, High Noon.
And now Birth of a Nation, I think, is also on that list.
That'll put you in movie jail.
I mean, it is kind of a movie jail movie. You should at least see the racist piece of shit.
Oh, I know. I know the movie I didn't see. The Magnificent Seven.
Oh.
That's my movie jam movie.
I have not seen that either.
We watched about 20 minutes of that. But, I mean, I've seen it before, but...
No, it's the Magnificent Seven. The dun 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 dun.
That's Bonanza.
No.
Bonanza, no.
Yeah, no, no.
No. It's basically the same thing. See, it's the same thing.
Bonanza, that was Morricone too, right?
Yeah, I think it was Morricone.
Lalo Schifrin, I believe.
Oh, yes.
Oh, wow. That guy's a Western fanatic. That is a Western fanatic.
Yeah, but I'm out of movie jail for High Noon. By the way, High Noon, hilarious movie, because that town is full of pussies. It is so funny. What's his name? I was about to say George C. Scott. Not George C. Scott.
Gary Cooper.
Tries to enlist the movie's in real time, so it's like an 85 or 90-minute movie that starts at, you know...
10:30 or whatever.
Yeah, exactly, and it goes in real time or whatever. And the whole movie is him going up to people and saying, you know, we got some bad guys coming into town. They're going to be in town on the whatever train, the noon train or whatever. It's like, I need some help, and can't do it. Nope, gotta get out of here. And everybody's like, moving. Nope, I'm leaving. I mean, there are people packing up their stuff as Gary Cooper's asking them to help. They're packing their things to go hop on a horse. I mean, it's so funny. And there's even one character that's like, he's like, I'm going to go rustle up some men. And he leaves. You don't see him for like an hour. And you're like, oh, he's going to come and help. He's gonna pop in at the last minute when Gary Cooper can't find him. He's going to bring a whole posse. No, he shows back up and he's like, I couldn't find anybody. Look, I'm also going to leave. But and then he goes into this mode. It's a great performance. We were cracking up. He's just like, look, I wanted to help. You know that. Like, he's totally backpedaling. Like, look, I was all for this. You realize. But I mean, I'm going to go, but I just wanted to know. I really wanted to. You know, anyway. It's really fun. And we thought it'd be a really funny at the very end if he's like, fuck this town. Like, why would I save it? Like, he's got to go face the three gunmen. But after all that, like, fuck this town. Yeah, but, I'm going to leave.
The big deal.
Yeah, you know what? You guys take over the town. What would put it's not worth the shit.
What would put you in movie jail?
People are like, I can't believe you haven't seen that movie.
Yeah, and
that usually comes
sometimes
up
come up all the time, yeah. The one you haven't seen. People quote it or something like that, you know?
Oh, I haven't seen Magnificent Seven either.
I haven't seen Magnificent Seven, no. Which is American Seven Samurai.
Yeah.
I believe, right?
Yeah.
Which I haven't seen.
I did see
No, that. I haven't seen that. Do you see Seven Samurai?
I have seen Seven Samurai, yeah. That's pretty amazing. I was in Toho Studios where they shot that.
Really? And Godzilla, and
Godzilla, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, it was really, I was there doing The Grudge, movie The Grudge.
Yeah.
It was a cool movie to make.
Was shot in Toho? That wasn't shot here?
No, they shot in Toho Studios.
Oh, that's awesome.
But here's the coolest thing. While I was there, they were shooting their version of like a Japanese sort of DOS boat. About a bunch of Japanese submariners during World War II in the next studio. And every time they take a break, you know, they hear the bells ring over there. And I was outside waiting one day. And like 50 extras, like 15 extras came out. The guys who were just actors on the boat. And it was frightening. They had the total, you know, World War II submariners costume. It was chilling. It was really chilling. I mean, obviously they look pretty authentic.
Yeah.
But it was awesome. It was awesome. Awesome studio. Yeah, and there's like Godzilla things everywhere.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah. Like the paintings lining the wall.
Yeah,
and stuff.
Some reproduction suits and stuff. It was really neat.
That reminds me, I was gonna say something earlier. The most exciting thing, because I can't remember, you said you saw some movie in Japan or I can't remember, we said something earlier, but it doesn't matter. One of the most exciting things I've ever seen was I visited a friend in Japan for a week, and there was a brand new Godzilla movie in theaters in Japan that I got to see with a full Japanese crowd. That was so cool.
That is cool.
And it was Godzilla Final Wars, if you've ever seen that one. And if you haven't, you must. Mm-hmm. It is the one where he fights literally everyone he's ever fought in all the movies. They do a new version of, it's man in suit, but they do new cool versions of, and he fights every single villain he's ever fought.
Rodan?
Mothra? You can't.
King Kong?
I'm talking down to Jet Jaguar. Talking down to, like, you know.
But first he goes around to all the other monsters and asks for help, and they're like, well, we're moving out of town, so good luck, Godzilla. You're on your own here.
And then at one point, the American Godzilla from the Matthew Broderick one jumps out, and he punches its head off. And that's it. Like, it don't even have a fight. He just punches its head
off. For
real? And everyone's like, Yeah. No, for real.
Did you start the USA chant at that point in the theater?
It was not the place to start it.
No. Even back here, that's not the place to start it.
I do have an answer for you real quick. The Bandit 2.
Why would that put you in movie jail? I mean, unless all your friends are truckers or something. Maybe, hey. I don't know.
Well, he can't sing Jerry Reed's follow-up to Eastbound and Down.
No.
Which there is. I think it was called Westbound and Convoy or something. I'm serious.
I never saw a Convoy.
Westbound and Up. Convoy?
No. We got a great big convoy.
Riding through the night.
Don't tell me. I could sing you the song, sure, but who saw the movie?
Chris Christopherson. Directed by Peckinpah.
Burt Young was in it.
Is that Peckinpah?
I think it was.
Peckinpah directed Convoy?
Peckinpah directed Chris Christopherson in Convoy.
I think that's true.
I haven't seen the whole thing.
I think that's true.
It's wonderfully sexist, the parts I've seen. I mean, if you're going to be sexist, be Chris Christopherson and Sam Peckinpah sexist.
Yeah.
We're done. We have come to a close with our segment with Ted.
What?
Oh,
but I do want to ask you what you got coming up.
Well,
I saw something called, Murder of a Cat.
Yeah.
What is that?
It's an indie movie with, who is in the movie?
Barry Lyndon.
No, J.K. Simmons I are in the movie together. We're cops. We both have. He's got a pretty sizable part. Excuse me, I have a rather small part. It's a
Good movie. It's one of these movies that was on a the famous Blacklist script.
Oh, yeah?
For those of you who don't know, the Blacklist is the list of 100 most talked about unproduced Hollywood scripts that get passed around from studios, get optioned, but for whatever reason, they're not making it too expensive or too weird or whatever, but they love them. This was one of these scripts about a guy who lives in a small town who has a cat, and one day his cat is murdered. So he goes to hunt. He's like this sort of 35-something ne'er-do-well, and he goes to hunt to figure out who killed his cat. He lives with his mother, and it's a weird, weird little story, but in doing so, he falls in love, and all these things happen, so that's a nice little movie.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, the opposite of
Greg Kinnear's in it, and he's very, very good.
Oh, I haven't seen him in a while.
Oh, he's
great. It's a little indie movie.
Why does he do that? Why does he just disappear? He just disappears, and he shows up every once in a while. He doesn't quite pull a Daniel Day-Lewis, who shows up every 5 years to remind everyone else how much they suck as an actor, and then he goes back and hides away. But Greg kind of does the same thing. He does great work, and then just kind of disappears.
He does, and one thing I forgot about him when I was there. I had one day with him and on that movie, and I was just goofing around like we are here telling jokes, and you cannot top him. He's so funny. I forget because he does these serious movies.
I know.
He started off as a stand-up.
Do you remember his talk soup?
He was great.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I've been trying to find clips of that on YouTube, which is impossible.
They don't have them.
They might have pulled them all.
They
know.
May have. That guy is funnier without saying a single word.
I'd love to watch some old talk soup with him.
Yeah, he was great.
They come out of those clips, and he says nothing, and you're on the floor. Just his look, his demeanor, his vibe is just brilliant. Absolutely.
You ever seen The Matador? Has the room seen The Matador?
Yes, I like that movie.
Fantastic.
What a weird little indie.
Did I lend that to you? Brosnan? Huh?
Did I lend that to you?
No, but I've been asking for it because I brought this up. This is the third time I brought it up on the show and going, I have to rewatch this.
I will lend it to anyone who wants to see. That movie's fantastic.
I think that's fantastic too, and it was a good, bold career choice for Pierce Brosnan to go, they will never, ever, ever let me be Bond. And I'm too old to be an action star, and I don't want to fight anybody anymore, so I'm going to go 180 degrees into this crazy-ass movie.
And it is cry crazy on ass. Screen all the time. Broken-down hitman.
Broken-down hitman sleeping with horrible horrors.
A really funny movie. It's got a twisted sense of humor.
Oh, yeah.
There you have it. Go to TedRaimi.com to find out what's
next. Do that.
And you're directing now too. You just directed a web series.
I did for Break Media, and which is like
which
Lions
is an anthology series too.
It's anthology horror. Yeah, that's pretty cool.
It's about El Marco.
El Marco? No.
I saw El Marco on TED.
Oh,
El Marco.
That was a little comedy show I directed a long time ago. I just threw that up there.
So if you like, but I should say because I watched it. If you like the comedy stylings of Ted Raimi in Xena and Hercules, that whole feel is translated to this. My favorite line, of course, they call him the Marco. Because El Marco.
That's right. They keep asking, you mean the Marco? No, El Marco. Yeah. But that means
and
the
he
Marco.
He sings songs and he fights bad guys.
Yeah, it is fun. I enjoy it. It was fun little short to make.
And at Ted Raimi on Twitter, you can also find out everything that he's up to as well. We'll be right back. Karen will return to the show and we'll wrap up things, but not before. Oh, let's have just a few more seconds of joy from the wonderful world of Xena and Hercules as we go out.
Forgot about this.
Not Tedus Joxer, but Tedus Joxer's brother Jace.
Yes. Flamboyant and Jace. Yes.
Thanks, Ted. Appreciate you coming
out. Thank you. Hey, thanks, guys. Hey. Thanks a lot. Fun.
This. I don't know this.
Everyone! Why don't you all throw up your hands and feel
is that you?
Yeah. Yeah.
Another one?
I played different brothers on that show. Uh-huh. And this was the very gay brother named Jace. Uh-huh. So there's Joxer the Idiot. It was really funny stuff they wrote. There's his very gay brother, Jace, and then the killer, Jed, who's just a psychopath. He just loves to kill people. So it was like...
And they're all played by you, right?
Oh, I played them all, yeah.
Oh, that's
That'll never happen again on TV where, like, you know, it wasn't a network show, so we got so much freedom and... When else is a comedy actor going to get to play three different parts?
That's great. Well,
repeatedly.
Well, don't you play three parts in They Call Me Bruce? Or
every movie I play.
And I think I
play multiple characters in most comedies I've done. But on TV, that was a weird one. Yeah. I mean, everyone in usually in a comedy show, it's typical for an actor to play their double. that's normal. But to play three parts on a regular basis is really weird. And, like, it didn't even seem weird at the time. Now, looking back, I'm like, they'd never let an actor do that. And I got so lucky. I don't know how it lucked out. Rob Tapper, you know, the producer. He's just so adventuresome.
How great was that on Xena? You're with all your childhood friends, right? Robert Tappert?
Rob Tappert was my childhood friend, and
Josh Becker,
my childhood friend. Yeah, both Detroiters, so old friends of mine. So it was great. It's just like it was great. It's like old buddies, just having fun together,
just like hanging out.
Yeah,
making TV, ridiculous TV.
Yeah, it was great. You know, and
I predict a huge Xena binge for me after this interview.
Yeah,
TV or all right. I know this is our outro music, but one more question: TV or film? Not in terms of what projects you've done that you're proudest of, but just in terms of as a working actor.
Like, what, my favorite?
Yeah, what do you take in that throwdown?
I'm sorry, in terms of a genre?
No, just what do you like working
on best? As a
Some people say the long hours of this or the tough.
It just breaks down this way: the money of TV and the art and the fun of making movies. TV's not all that much. TV's kind of a grind, but the money's great. Movies, you go broke, but you feel like an artist.
There you have it.
That's pretty good.
That's all I got to say to that.
That's a good quote. All right. Hey, we're actually going to go to break this time. Thanks, Ted.
Oh, wait, one last question.
Get out of
here. You got a good Roy Scheider story?
Or an impersonation of Roy Scheider?
Nah. He was on Sequest. Oh, I mean, Jesus. The legendary... sorry, Paul.
Well, here's Roy on set. Roy would do this. They'd say... here's my first time I ever met Roy. Folks, cast members of Sequest, producers, want to tell you you're coming in on Saturday, per usual, as we all do it on TV shows, for cast and crew photos for promotion. Pause. Thank you. Pause. Roy Scheider out of the side of the room.
Nah. You take pictures on your time. Saturday is our time. You understand? Let me show you how it works.
Roy turns around and walks out. It was awesome. And of course, all of us actors standing in front of, you know, Steven Spielberg's men are like, well, that was really terrible. That was really shameful. And secretly, we're like, look at Roy, I love you!
None of you worked on Jaws.
He will be missed.
There you go.
Awesome. That's great. So funny. I didn't know he... played three characters.
And the reason that's rare is because that you really are obligated.
Why don't you all throw up your hands and feel the rhythm?
The union doesn't like you to do that.
Take my brother James.
Take work away from two other people.
Oh, playing two different characters.
Eddie Murphy.
Yeah, they hate it. Well,
such a Peter Sellers move.
I think he's paying a fine for all those.
Oh, yeah.
For real?
I would believe so. It's $320 or something like that. Oh, but okay. It's, yeah.
Hey, we're back, everybody. And, Karen is not here today because she's off in audition, so hopefully it's going well. So that means...
That's probably a good sign.
Yeah, if you stay there a long time.
I've never had a really long bad audition. Stick around, you keep sucking.
We want more of that.
Yeah.
I have a theory that Ted Raimi's just good luck, maybe.
There you go. No, it's one of those rare auditions where they just want her to keep trying until she gets the part. Instead of going, nope, next.
Ted's birthday is next week, actually.
Oh, yeah.
On the 14th.
December birthday.
So, yeah, maybe we'll drop a little.
Along with?
Me.
And?
Adam.
Me.
Yeah,
and excellent. Fred Mowery and Dave Sachs.
And not me. I'm in March. All right, I screwed it up. But Hollywood is putting out a ton of movies, racing to get them out in time for a year-end Oscar qualification. So we'll get to what Karen saw this week next week as well. But for now, without Karen here, I guess it's up to me to do the birthdays.
Paul does here the birthdays? Go. What a crazy variation on a formula!
No, Adam, he just drew the short straw.
Let's start off our birthdays by wishing a happy birthday to Marissa Tomei.
Oh, I'd love a happy birthday all over her.
Well, this is going to be funny. You're doing it in Karen's voice, but I know you really want to back Marissa Tomei.
You're totally right, sir.
I'm going to draw sort
you
of
are correct, my
lesbian
good man.
Feel here.
She turns 49, but can play anywhere from hottie in 1992 to current day hottie.
Oh, cougar hottie.
It's as if I wrote that. You all know Marissa Tomei as the Oscar award-winning actress from My Cousin Vinny. To me, Marissa Tomei is my personal dialect coach for whenever I have to play a New Yorker. that would be Karen.
And then Karen does it great.
But do I know her as a winner? Is that still up for debate? Was that still?
Oh,
a,
the whole is that palettes read the wrong name?
Oh, that's bullshit.
I hope it is. It has to be, right?
That is an overly planned performance. I mean, that nothing is more produced than that show on Earth, right?
Yeah.
And how do you read the wrong name? Are there six names?
No, they don't put more than one name. That is such a dumb
rumor. They don't highlight
the
one. They just, there's one name on the card.
There's just one name on the card. Come on. Yeah, exactly. Here, read one of these three. Circle the one. Come on.
She says here, she won Best Supporting Actress that year over such schlubs as Vanessa Redgrave for Howard's End, Judy Davis for Husbands and Wives, Joan Plowright for Enchanted April, and Miranda Richardson for Damage. Good Lord, that is a casting call of high end prestige names.
Wow.
Tomei beat them all. Hey, which one of these women went on to a long and successful movie career? Oh, wait, almost all of them. I mean, Miranda would probably still be working if it weren't for that skiing accident.
Who? What?
Okay, Karen, that's Natasha Richardson. Miranda Richardson. Oh, Jesus Christ. Which, you know, normally her skiing accident would not be hilarious.
That's Sonny Bono.
That's a hilarious ski accident.
Anyway, what's important here isn't whether she won the award for real or not. It's that she's still super hot at 49. You go, girl.
Thanks, Paul.
Kick Karen. Next up, let's wish a happy birthday to the man of imagination, Mr. Walt Disney.
Oh.
Who died at the age of 65.
Perfect timing.
Wow.
But his head just turned 113.
He smoked 25 packs.
I didn't know he died that young. But I mean, I guess I don't remember picking.
That's when you died, you smoked all the time.
Is that right?
Yeah.
He didn't have, I don't have images in my head of like a super old Walt Disney. So yeah, 65 is I guess when it was. But anyway.
Tell how old we are.
When I was a kid
65
watching.
65 is not that old.
Yeah.
Whenever I have images of
Walt. I was so young. Remember when you were a kid and 40 was so old.
Like ancient.
Ancient. Yeah.
Fuck.
Whenever I have images of Walt Disney, I have to intentionally not think of John Waters.
Oh, yeah, he's got a John Waters thing going on, doesn't he?
Not him, the other guy.
Yeah. Here, Karen wrote something I think we could all agree with.
Okay.
When I was a kid watching all of those Sunday night shows, The Wonderful World of Disney, I always thought he was alive.
Ah, yes!
Yeah, you're right.
I didn't watch those shows and go, he's dead.
Was he dead by then? But he was died before we were born.
No. I don't think that's true.
I think so.
No, I seem to remember in Tim Burton's biography that
Tim Burton's in his 50s.
But there was a huge flux of changeover in 81, 82 because Walt had died and they didn't know how to run the company. So I think he did die in like 80 or something.
Oh, fuck, I got to do math. All right, hang on. I was going to say, there's the calculator on the computer.
There is a way to figure this out. Pretty simply. He was 65 when he died. He was born in
so 113 is how old he would be today.
Oh, that's a real number.
Yeah. All right. His head is.
Minus 2013.
Minus 65. Equals 48, so 48 years ago, which is older than any of
everyone
us.
Everyone else, yeah.
What? Hold on, I'm going to look this up.
Right, you look it up. In the meantime...
Here, there's another way to do it. Siri, when did Walt Disney die?
Have all of you been to Disneyland?
Yes. World and Land.
World and Land.
World and Land.
Yeah, yeah.
And Epcot, which just sucks.
And this is true for Karen. My first trip to Disney World was when I was 28, and it was still magical.
Oh, wow.
I had to take that girl. I had to take that girl, show her Disney World. I had to show her E.T., I don't know what kind of childhood she had.
Karen.
Thank God I came along.
Wow. Karen, I am talking to you.
That's pretty magical.
But she can't imagine going there as a 6-year-old girl. My head would explode.
Oh, yeah.
Totally. I forgot. I jumped in. I jumped I jumped first person to third person. Anyway.
You would.
All right, back to Karen. And lastly, happy birthday to one of my favorite dudes.
I'm the dude. That's what you call me. You know? That or his dudeness or duder or, you know, El Duderino, if you're not into the whole brevity thing.
Yes, Jeff Bridges turns 64, but can play anywhere from craggy old Rooster Cogburn in True Grit to Rooster Cogburn in R.I.P.D. I came late to the Jeff Bridges party. For some reason, I remember seeing him in The Fabulous Baker Boys, and then I somehow missed all of his other movies except for True Grit. I mean, I saw him in movies, but I didn't realize what an absolute force to be reckoned with he actually was. But this is a good thing. Now I have the pleasure of going back and seeing classic Jeff Bridges movies like Seabiscuit, The Big Lebowski, Fearless, which I loved but didn't know he was in, The Fisher King, and the list goes on. This is Karen. You know,
wow.
She,
yeah.
She, well, but how she loved that movie, Fearless. That movie is scary as shit. It's a Peter Weir film from 1993 about plane crash survivors.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
Karen was a wreck. I, like, carried her out of that theater. And she doesn't know Jeff Bridges was the guy?
I never saw Fabulous Beggar Boys. Movie Jail. Movie Jail.
No, I have not seen that either.
I don't know
either.
If it's Movie Jail, but goddamn, is that a good movie.
Not seen that, yeah.
That's a great movie.
It's
film.
With the Bridges brothers. And,
yeah. Oh, Bo's best thing he's
McPants.
Ever done.
What's McCotty Pants?
Michelle Pfeiffer. Yeah.
But man, he's also just so enjoyable from like a boyish point of view too. Like some of the like Tron, of course.
King Kong.
Yeah. I just watched that last year. God, it's still so
Wait,
good.
The King Kong with Jack Black?
No, with Charles Grodin.
Charles Grodin
and Jessica Lange.
Yeah.
1970s.
And it holds up.
Does it really?
Yes,
no way.
It absolutely does.
Things in the 70s don't hold
up. No, they
do. Fake monkeys from the 70s never hold up.
Look, if you're going to point out a bunch of fucking Matt lines, then I don't want to watch a movie with you anyway. Get over it. Like, I like how people can't...
Matt lines.
Right?
I love how many people are calling out in Matt line notifications?
No, I love how people are like, oh, you can look, that's so matted in or whatever, or so...
Well, not just the effects,
Compton,
but,
you know.
You can goof on 70s movies in general sometimes.
But I think the it's a man in suit gorilla in that one. Yeah. And it's really good. It's Rick Baker. Did the gorilla suit. I think that gorilla looks the best of all of them in some ways. It's got a good look about it.
I honestly haven't seen it in forever and a day.
Yeah, no, I thought it was going to be totally terrible. But
yeah. All right, and there you go. But as we all know, I love when celebrities sing...
Yes, Karen.
So here's a little number from the very talented and sexy Jeff Bridges from his awesome 2010 movie, Crazy Heart. There you go. And that does it for the movie showcase.
Hey! This is the song.
So I'm back to Paul now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Gee, where'd you go?
Together we are the Movie Guys. Individually we are...
Lee Guys. Right. Karen Volpe sits over there.
Follow us on Twitter at The Movie Guys, on Facebook at Facebook.com/TheMovieGuys, as well as YouTube, iTunes, SoundCloud, Vine, Instagram. We'll do something with Google Plus one day. They say it's gonna stick around.
I keep getting... People keep saying they're on it.
Yeah, they tie it to YouTube.
It's already out in France. It's Google Plus.
I mean...
Thank you. Like Canal Plus.
Canal Plus.
Thanks to Ted Raimi.
Oh, yay, yeah. Mr. Raimi.
TedRaimi.com.
Enjoyable human being.
Jesus, that guy's a freaking tour de force.
I could have talked to him for another hour. We should have and absolutely. Just put it out as a separate thing. What were we thinking?
Well, he
had to go.
Part of the Movie Guys box set this Christmas.
There you go. Makes him a wonderful gift. And thanks to Steve Schultz for his writing contributions to the show every week. And remember, you can find everything we're up to at themovieguys.net. Thanks for listening.
Thank you.
Oh, this is Jeff Bridges and the Abiders. That's his band. Did you know
that? Oh, that's terrific. The Abiders. I feel like maybe I heard that. Yeah, that's pretty terrific.
All right, thanks. Get out of here. Or
love that he acknowledges.
We can keep talking again over the music. Never let it act. The outro.
I thought
music.
That was a good bit. It only went two beats with Ted, but I thought that was pretty funny. And we got a good Roy Scheider story out of it.
Oh, the best. This
must be awesome. The price you pay. And of course, the audience missed. The audience missed the Ted Raimi show after we stopped recording that. He told four more stories before he left.
Yeah.
That was hilarious.
Find him and make him, you know, when you find him on the street, make him tell you stories about.
And a Harrison Ford impersonation?
Make him tell you a story.
He did four stories and three impersonations after we cut the mics.
On the way to the car.
That is Philip Noyce.
He did Philip Noyce. I mean, it's fantastic.
Goodbye. Get out of here.
Good night. We did get to do the video.